Coverage on ESPN, brought to you by USAA.
Veterans Week on ESPN, brought to you by USAA, continues from Memorial Stadium in Champaign. It's a rivalry game in the Big Ten as the Illinois Fighting Illini take on the Purdue Boilermakers with the Cannon Trophy on the line. Also, these two teams battling for positioning in the Big Ten West. Brett Bielema's resurrection of the Illini has them alone at the top, with Purdue and four others very much still in the mix for the Big Ten West. You're watching ESPN College Football, presented by Sonos. Hi, everybody. Alongside Dustin Fox, the national champion with the Buckeyes, I'm Jay Alter. Well, this game could very well decide who's going to play for a Big Ten championship in Indianapolis in a couple of weeks.
Well, it's really huge for Illinois specifically. They win this game, they're in the driver's seat for the Big Ten West. They finish the season with Michigan and Northwestern.
It'll be Purdue that starts with the football, and slow starts have troubled the Boilermakers this season. They've gone down 17-0 and 14-0 in the last 2 weeks against Iowa and Wisconsin. Purdue now trying to save their season on the road against an Illinois team that's 7-2, one of the best stories in college football this season. A lot to play for in the Big Ten. What's better than meaningful cold weather football in November between two Big Ten rivals? Purdue's offense about to head out. Let's check down on the field with Lauren Sisler.
Yeah, guys, Purdue is coming off two straight losses, but it's not because they can't finish games. It's because of how they've started their football games. Turnovers have been critical for them, really setting them back, forcing them to change their game plan and play from behind. But talking to the coaching staff this week, there's a lot of this is not a struggling offense. They've got some of the top personnel in the Big Ten right now. They just need to start fast with no turnovers so they can execute at a much higher level of confidence, even down the stretch in close games.
Now they've got a reliable quarterback. Aiden O'Connell, a sixth-year senior, leads the Big Ten in passing per game, throwing on first down, not a surprise. Going to be a tall task today for O'Connell.
You know, O'Connell has been one of the better quarterbacks in the Big Ten the last couple of seasons, Jay. But for whatever reason this year, it's been the turnovers. 10 interceptions on the year. He had 10 last season in the entire year, right? So specifically the last 3 weeks, he's thrown 5 picks. This Illinois defense, 16 interceptions on the season.
Second and 14 after a loss of 4. They go to Devin Maccabee, and he's stopped after a gain of 2. Third and long on the opening drive for Purdue. Dustin, Purdue and O'Connell going against one of the best defenses in college football, and they've shown off on the opening two plays.
This defense gets after you, especially in third and long situations. They're going to line up, play man-to-man coverage most of this game, and force Aiden O'Connell to beat you.
The Illini lead the nation in interceptions this season. Third and 12, quick hitter, Maccabee. Couple of cuts. Picks up the first down, Devin Maccabee, the redshirt freshman. They call him Crazy Legs for his unorthodox running style, and we saw it there.
You absolutely saw it there, and that's where I think Purdue's going to have to make some hay this afternoon. It's going to be with the backs and the tight ends. Their corners in the back end for Illinois are tremendous. The last couple of weeks, the offenses, Nebraska and Michigan State made some plays in the flat and down the seam with their tight ends and running backs. So that's a nice big conversion. Good start for the Purdue offense.
Against an Illini defense that's been so strong this season, rare they'd give up a third and long. O'Connell, plenty of time, has the tight end wide open. Payne Durham, and it's another first down into Illini territory on this opening drive.
And this is really credit to the offensive line. Aiden O'Connell has all day to throw. Payne Durham kind of runs like an in-cutting route, but as O'Connell scrambles out to his right, you got man-to-man coverage. Sidney Brown, the top safety for Illinois, is in coverage with Payne Durham. Easy pitch and catch for the first down. Nice start for Purdue.
They go to Maccabee. Big hole. He runs right through it, falling forward. He's tripped up 1 yard shy of the first down. How about the emergence of Devin Mockamy, redshirt freshman, two-star recruit coming out of high school? He was headed to Navy 2 weeks before he's going to Annapolis. Purdue calls, says, forget Annapolis, come to Indianapolis. And he has been quite a fit in the backfield for the Boilermakers.
And nobody really thought that he would really play much this year as just a freshman. You know, you had King Daroo was the quarter or the running back to start the year, and he's injured.
Only needed a yard, and that's exactly what Payne Durham picks up there. Purdue driving on this Illinois defense, Dustin, but surprising considering how strong they've been this season.
Yeah, this defense has been so fun to watch as we prepared for this game, Jay. They're unbelievable at really every level of the defense. Number one, of course, in the nation points per game. Number one in total defense. And the 16 interceptions, to me, that stands out. That is the back end just making plays, and really credit to their front creating havoc.
And when you're number one in the country in takeaways, points allowed, yards allowed, you've got a really strong defense. We were thinking, how could they be better than Georgia? But statistically, they are, as a flag comes out on the 34-yard line.
Yeah, they're going to get pass interference here, I think, on Kendall Smith. He was just a little bit early. And as cold as it is on days like today, those flags sometimes come out a little late.
The ball is placed at the spot of the foul, includes an automatic first down.
We'll see number seven come in here just a little bit early. Trying to get the football to Sheffield there over the middle, and Walters is like, come on, man, what are you doing?
That's defensive coordinator Ryan Walters. He designed this unique defense that is number one in all those categories we just told you. Brought it to Illinois. They put five up front, trust their coverage. O'Connell surveys the field, throws it out of bounds. Coverage did their job there.
Really a concerted effort to start this game by Purdue to try and target their tight end, Payne Durham. And on all three times they've targeted him, it's Sidney Brown in coverage. Sidney Brown, of course, the twin brother of Chase Brown, who we'll talk a ton about when Illinois gets the football. But I definitely think you're going to see a lot more targets to Payne Durham. Have not seen Charlie Jones get a target in this game yet.
Number 15 in white leads the Big Ten in receptions with 83. O'Connell on second and 10, clean pocket again. Got about 5 yards, so sets up a third and man. Marshawn Rice on the grab.
And Jones now back in the game here on a big third down, top of the screen. And that'll be Devin Witherspoon matched up against him.
Third and five. Illini bring pressure. Incomplete. Knocked away by the safety, Kendall Smith, in coverage. Taz Nicholson as well. That's what makes this secondary so elite.
Yeah, they've got elite corners, and they've got excellent physical safeties. Nicholson here matched up. Again, man-to-man coverage on the outside. Taz Nicholson, they're glad to have him back here. That ball's thrown right in front. And I don't know that you can cover it any better than that.
Fourth and five. Jeff Brom leaves the offense on the field. Big test for O'Connell. O'Connell steps up, fires, incomplete. Turnover on downs. He was trying to get it to the tight end, Payne Durham.
Kendall Smith is in coverage here. Kendall Smith, what a great story he is. Thought he was going to transfer out before the season. Wasn't really happy about playing time. Has been moved into that starting role for the Illini at the free safety position and does a great job there on fourth down. This is a difficult task. Payne Durham is going to be an NFL tight end. Ball thrown a little bit high, but really good coverage by Kendall Smith. So a good start by the Illini defense. We talked about them all open, and here they go, getting off the field on fourth down.
Big Ten rivalry game between Purdue and Illinois just getting started. Purdue got it all the way to the Illini 26, turnover on down. So now Chase Brown and the Illinois offense on the field. for their first drive of the game. Brown, the leading rusher in the nation. And they go right to him for a gain of 6 on his first carry. Brown, not only the nation's leading rusher, but today he's chasing some history. 35 yards away from becoming the Illini's second all-time leading rusher, 93 yards away from 3,000 in an Illinois uniform. And he's had 9 straight games to start this season with 100 yards or more. Incredible.
He's in pretty good company in that group. It's elite. And he is an elite running back for this Illini offense, and he's got a terrific offensive line to run behind.
DeVito taking a shot. It's caught. What a grab. Brian Hightower with Reese Taylor all over him somehow makes a spectacular catch.
And give a lot of credit to Chase Brown, who picks up the defensive end who's coming off the edge. And here you'll see Hightower down the field. This is great hand-eye coordination to catch this football, and Taylor's in really good position on the outside. Chunk play to start the game for the Illini.
All the focus goes to Chase Brown because he is the nation's leading rusher. Yes. He's so talented, but DeVito, an excellent quarterback as well. Throwing again. Wide open for another Illini first down. Tip Ryman, the tight end. Move the chains again for Tommy DeVito, who's out slinging it on the opening drive.
You kind of had a feeling that Illinois might come out in this game, Jay, and try to push the football down the field a little bit. That Purdue secondary vulnerable against the big play.
They go back to Brown. Holes opened up. Tripped up at the 10. Chase Brown showing why he's the nation's leading rusher on this opening drive. Gain of 14.
What a great block on this play by Alex Pilstrom, the center down the field. You like pancakes in the morning? I like pancakes. Look at 75, the center. Could have come around and all the way down the field, get himself a pancake block.
Brown cuts at the 5, tackled at the 2. Illinois getting everything they want on this opening drive.
Chase Brown has been so much fun to watch this season. And obviously a tough loss a week ago against Michigan State, but had they not lost that game, I think he still should be in the conversation for the Heisman Trophy.
They give it right back to him. Touchdown, Illinois! Six play, 74-yard drive for the Illini, and Chase Brown caps it off with a touchdown.
And this offensive line just gets a great push. What a way to start the game. You hand it off to Chase Brown up the gut, breaks a tackle, gets himself into the end zone. OC Brothers is there trying to make the tackle as Brown finds his way into the end zone. Boy, that was an efficient drive, Jay. Right down the field.
Tommy DeVito was 2 for 2, 44 yards. Chase Brown, 4 carries, 30 yards. They made it look easy. Caleb Griffin on for the extra point. Puts it right through. What a start for Illinois. They get the turnover on downs on defense and then drive it 74 yards for the opening score.
And the last 4 games, specifically the red zone, it's been an issue for the Illini. Just 4 touchdowns the last 4 games. Guess what? Opening drive, house call in the red zone.
College football is presented by Sonos. Experience game-changing sound made easy.
98th meeting in this rivalry game of the Big Ten between Purdue and Illinois. They play for the Cannon Trophy. Pretty even historically, but Purdue as of late has dominated this series. They've won 5 of the last 6, but trailing after that stellar opening drive for Illinois. 6 plays, 74 yards. Dustin, they made it look easy.
Didn't even have a third down. They just went right down the field efficiently and effectively.
Touchback And we get another look at this Purdue offense. They did well to get it all the way to the Illini 26, but then the drive stalled out. And curious, we didn't see a lot of number 15 in white, Charlie Jones, who's the leading receiver in the Big Ten.
Yeah, he is, and he's getting 13 targets a game. I mean, he has been primarily their entire offense this season. I talked about it, 31 Devin Witherspoon is going to match up man-to-man with him all day long. And we'll see, because Witherspoon, again, one of the top corners in the entire country as well.
In the last six games, Witherspoon has only allowed five receptions for 19 yards, so something's got to give in that matchup. Check in with Lauren on the sideline.
Guys, I think it's worth noting Charlie Jones has been battling multiple lower body injuries this season, so they've had to be really smart with his reps, especially in practice. Coach McGee said he's always fighting to be out there, but he tries to limit him in his essential reps so he can be more fresh during the game. And you saw him come out and warm up earlier, but he was kind of staying away from the team and trying to really kind of get warmed up and loosen up before he was taking those reps in warm-ups.
And I can tell you what, from playing in these conditions, when you're battling some sort of an injury, it's really tough to get loose.
Cold weather, November football in the Big Ten. Hello! Up over the top, Payne Durham, the hurdle to pick up the first down and more for Purdue.
Payne Durham again making a tremendous play. And O'Connell, you know, typically we talked about it, he's typically looking to Charlie Jones. On this play, they find Durham over the middle. And how about that hurdle?
That's 6'5", 255 pounds going up in the air.
He was a lacrosse player, not a hurdler in high school. Looked like one there.
Back to the ground game, pushing that pile, Devin McAbee. 5 yards for Purdue. They've had a lot of positive yardage on first down, which has been critical for a team that struggled to start games. They've gotten down 17-0 and 14-0 in the last 2 weeks.
And really last week, you know, third down killed them. They were 2-for-13 on third down a week ago. Must be better here in this game. And it's not going to get any easier against the nation's top defense.
Play action. O'Connell slings it on a slant route. Another first down for Purdue. First catch of the game for TJ Sheffield to move the chains.
I think they're comfortable trying to get the ball out of O'Connell's hands quickly. You know, just an easy, quick slant, man-to-man coverage against Tyler Strain, the corner. And Sheffield, and both Sheffield and Mershon Rice have kind of emerged the last couple weeks. They've been looking for that number two wide receiver here to go along with Charlie Jones.
McAbee running left, trying to turn the corner, but met by two Illini defenders, Keith Randolph and Calvin Hart. Tonight on ABC, Saturday Night Football presented by Capital One features undefeated TCU against a hungry Texas team playing at home in Austin. Coverage begins 7:30 Eastern Time, also available on the ESPN app.
You can see how deep the free safety Kendall Smith plays in his defense, almost 20 yards deep.
O'Connell throws incomplete. Great coverage. This is Illini secondary. And that time,
that's
Devin Witherspoon.
There he is. That's the matchup all day. 31 on 15. We talked with Devin Witherspoon yesterday. We had a chance to chat with him. He's a little bit more animated on the field. Look at this man off, right? Plays the hips, sees when he breaks down, drives on the football.
Timed it perfectly.
Absolutely perfectly.
The last Purdue drive stalled out at the Illini 26. They're on the 27 right now for a 3rd and 8. O'Connell, quick hitter. McAbee dropped it.
Oh, he had it.
Had plenty of room in front of him. Devin McAbee just could not hold on. 4th and 8, they went for it on the previous fourth down, kicking into the wind here.
And this wind is tricky, Jay. We were down the field before the game. It's not necessarily straight into you. It's almost like kind of a cross,
a diagonal
wind. Yeah.
Yep. Blowing at 14 miles per hour right now. Tough task for Mitchell Finneran, the fifth-year senior who's made plenty of big kicks in his Purdue career, from 45 into the wind. good. Inches away from putting Purdue on the board. The Boilermakers drive deep into Illini territory and come up empty on back-to-back drives. A Big Ten battle. Cold weather, the wind's blowing here in November. You're watching the Big Ten on ESPN at a West Divisional rivalry game here at Champaign. The home team, Illini, up on Purdue, 7-0. A little more than 5 minutes left to this opening quarter. They go to the ground game with Reggie Love to start this drive. Let's check in with the studio. Kevin Connors, what do you got?
All right, Jay, your AT&T countdown to the CFP. Acho, in the snow of Columbus, C.J. Stroud off to a good start.
Six-play, 65-yard drive. This passing touchdown is 30th to Emeka Ibuka.
Buckeyes knocking on the door for more, Jay. It's 7-0 right now.
The Buckeyes on top early over the Hoosiers.
Former Buckeye, Big Ten national champion, Dustin Fox. Lauren Sisler down on the sideline. Jay Alter with you. Dustin, you know all too well what's it like to play in these cold weather, big time, Big Ten games that'll decide championships and trophies.
Every time I visited Champaign, these were the weather conditions. It's November, it's 32 degrees, there's flurries in the air, and the hits are a little bit harder. And when the division's on the line like it is today, a lot of fun.
With that cold weather, the hits are just that much harder. Branson Dean stays down after the tackle. You were telling me during that national championship season with the Buckeyes, you came to Champaign and almost blew the season. There would be no national championship.
We were number two in the country. We come here, Illinois, I think they were 4-5, and took us to overtime. We nearly blew that game, but
third coming out.
Still a lot of good memories here. A lot of good football played in the early 2000s here in Champaign. Their last Big Ten championship back in 2001.
Yeah, this is the best season that Illini fans have enjoyed since 2007 when they went to the Rose Bowl. With the injury still being attended to the field, let's go into the studio with Kevin again.
Yeah, and Jay, we showed you Ohio State knocking on the door. Bounce back opportunity for Tennessee. Acho with Jabari Small.
Speaking of bounce back, the hole was in the middle. Jabari Small bounced it outside. Great vision, great elusiveness, touchdown.
And Tennessee is knocking on the door again. Jay and Dustin at 7-0.
Kevin Connors, Sam Acho keeping you posted with games from around the nation. And it's a loaded early window. Great college football Saturday across ESPN's family of networks. Let's check out the biggest games of the weekend with our Crumble Cookie Weekend Menu. Right after us on ESPN2, a game that'll likely decide the American. UCF taking on Tulane. Over on ABC, Nebraska against Michigan. And then how about the nightcap? Georgia, Mississippi State, TCU, Texas, and North Carolina, Wake Forest. Three terrific games.
Excited to see Mississippi State and Georgia tonight. Georgia's a big favorite, but that is a tough place to play at night. Stark Vegas.
Third and six for Tommy DeVito in the Illini offense. DeVito slings it out of bounds, incomplete.
Just trying to find his top target, Isaiah Williams, on the outside, and I'm not sure if the wind took that one, but that one was way over the head of Williams.
That's a great response from the Purdue defense. It looked way too easy on that first drive for Brett Bielema's offense. So, you know, Purdue's defense, even early in this game, in the danger zone, if they allow another score, great response.
I thought that was a terrific response, Jay. Good point. Had they, you know, basically done the same thing they did in the opening drive, I would be extremely worried if I were a Purdue fan, but that was a nice response. And listen, Purdue's offense, they've moved the ball this afternoon. They just haven't been able to capitalize.
Here's Charlie Jones, breaks a tackle, picks up positive yardage across the 20. So we've seen two Boilermaker drives, Aiden O'Connell and the Purdue offense. They've done a nice job driving the ball downfield. No points to show for it, though. The two previous drives have stalled out at the Illini 26 and 27. How do they keep it going, sustain that drive through and get some points?
Well, listen, they've got to be better on third downs, obviously. And when they get inside that kind of, you know, approaching the red area, I think you got to look to your top two guys. It's Durham and Jones. And Durham's already got three catches on the day, the tight end, number 87. Look, they've already got more plays than more plays and yards than Illinois.
Play action, throwing on first down. Charlie Jones, the top target with his first catch of the day. No, he dropped it.
Oh, that's got to be caught on the outside by Jones. Witherspoon in coverage, playing a little bit of soft man. Just a quick out. I mean, this ball's thrown on the money. Got to be caught.
He's got the surest hands in the Big Ten. Leads the conference in receiving. You can tell there was a bobble there. Great call by the officials. Usually, if you throw to number 15, he's in the area. He'll make the grab. O'Connell goes right back to him, and this time he does hang on for the first down. Charlie Jones atones for the drop. Gain of 14.
See, I sort of like that combination. What they did was they put Jones and Durham on the same side, and one of them's going to make a play. Durham settles down. Jones runs in behind, and Jones is just wide open, settling in that zone as Witherspoon comes in for the tackle.
Boilermakers offensive line holding up strong against a tenacious front five for the Illini. Aiden O'Connell's had more time than we expected back there throwing the football. Minutes left to this opening quarter. Purdue's done a really nice job against this number one offense or defense in the country for Illinois. Leads the nation in least points allowed and yards allowed. They're doing well on the points, but Purdue has been effective all day back there for O'Connell. Unloads a deep ball. Incomplete.
Should have been picked off by Quan Martin. This ball is underthrown a little bit, but it goes through his hands, and the ball was nearly caught by Deion Burks. All day to throw, but excellent coverage in the back end by the Illini. You see 21's in coverage here. That's Quan Martin. Goes right through his hands.
And Burks actually had a chance to catch that ball. Wasn't expecting it to get through to him. Empty set. Third and eight for Aiden O'Connell. Pressure coming. O'Connell fires incomplete. There's a flag against Devin Witherspoon. One of the best shutdown corners in the game. Just extended this Purdue drive.
Charlie Jones is so crafty with the way he runs his routes.
Defense number 31.
Top of your screen. There's Charlie Jones. There's Witherspoon. That's the matchup all day. It's man-to-man coverage. He's just going to grab the jersey a little too much. He can't come back to the football. And a rare flag on Witherspoon.
Kobe Lewis with the carry. Stuffed up. Gain of two. O'Connell, pump fake, now throws, it's intercepted! Tyler Strain in perfect position to pick off Aiden O'Connell, his 11th interception of the season, and this is what the Illini defense is so effective at doing.
And they confuse you at the snap. they disguise. And in this particular play, they're going to play a little bit of a, it looks like a zone behind it, almost a cover two look, and Strain drops into the flat, and O'Connell just does not see him. Goes up, gets the football, and turns into a running back, and now the offense is going to have excellent field position here.
Devin Witherspoon loves it. He knows the feeling. He's got an interception this season, one of the best shutdown corners in the game. They threw it away from him for good reason, but Tyler Strain there to pick it off. There's Chase Brown, hard running on first down, gains three.
Boy, he gave a lick to Jamari Brown, the cornerback on the outside. You see Chase Brown, we talked with the Illinois staff, just talked about he's the real deal. You know, he's an NFL type back. He can run through you, he can run around you, he can make you miss.
Brett Bielema's defense has an interception in each of the last 13 games. Risky pass, that was almost picked off. Brings up third and seven. Scotty hump pick. Almost had his hands on it. Let's see if the Illini can cash in on this great field position following the interception. Nation's leading 17th interception of the season for Illinois. Third and seven, DeVito steps up, throws, incomplete. A little too much on it. Pat Bryant put a hand out but couldn't snare it and bring it in.
Bielema's going to trust his defense. I think had they been a little bit further along inside Purdue territory, they would go for this. Not in this situation.
You know, it's interesting. We were talking to Brett Bielema about how do you make the decision on fourth down, because they went for it six times last week, and he says he makes the decision on first down. He tells the coordinator on first down, hey, we're in four down territory. Robertson gets it away. Charlie Jones letting it bounce, and the Illini down it inside the five. Let's head to the studio with Kevin Connors. What's going on?
Bug J, Twisted T drop-in takes us to Baltimore. Sam Acho, explain to me how Braden Lindsey makes this catch.
Well, it's quite simple. You know how when you have kids and you play games with your kids, you just kind of play, keep away, and you catch it over? That's what Braden Lindsey just did. This is outstanding.
Arms around the defender to haul it in. Navy just scored, Jay. It's 14-6.
Wow, what a catch. Dustin, as a former cornerback, is
shuddering
at that.
Tremendous.
You couldn't play any better coverage.
No, he's right there.
Goes around him. Wow. You'll see that on SportsCenter top 10 plays later today.
Well, O'Connell. Not where you want to be if you're Purdue.
And Purdue backed up inside their own five, running it on first down. Maccabee. Calvin Avery on the tackle for Illinois. Five gives some breathing room to this Boilermakers offense.
And Jay, again, we've studied this defense. You know, Kendall Smith, their free safety, he's barely in the screen. He's back 21 yards deep.
Purdue content to go to the second quarter, trailing 7-0. They've had three drives, turnover on downs, a missed field goal, and an interception. Jeff Brohm, his team looking for a spark in a Big Ten battle between the Illini and the Boilermakers.
I'm Specialist Sean Fogelman here from Indianapolis, Indiana. Here in beautiful Camp Arif Shan Kuwait with the U.S. Arsen Public Affairs. Just want to give a shout out to my Purdue Boilermakers. Keep it up this season. Can't wait to continue to watch you. Boiler up.
So awesome. Thanks to Sean Fogelman. Veteran Week at ESPN, brought to you by USAA, continues this weekend. Huge shout out to Purdue, Illinois vets all around the world, all our vets serving our country, wherever you may be. A huge thank you. Dustin Fox, Jay Alter, and Lauren Sisler with you. Start of the second quarter. Purdue offensively, they've actually looked pretty good considering they've got 0 points to show for it. Three drives, so they went 49 yards, 48 yards, turnover on downs, a missed field goal. The last drive, the interception hurt, but they're facing an Illini defense that Brett Bielema calls the best fire department in the country because they always come to the rescue.
No doubt. And here another big third down for Purdue.
Illini send five. O'Connell threads the needle right to the sticks. First down, Purdue.
It's Andrew Sawinski, just his seventh catch of the year.
This was a tight window. Yeah. O'Connell somehow squeezes it in there.
He runs out to the flat and kind of sticks his foot in the ground, comes back on a slant. Working against Quan Martin.
O'Connell's shown the ability to drive on this top-ranked Illini defense. They just can't punch it in, can't find points. Blown up in the backfield. Devin Maccabee swallowed up by Alec Bryant.
Alec Bryant, who's getting a lot more action today because Seth Coleman is missing this game in concussion protocol. Unblocked, top of the screen, number 90 comes in. And that's a huge tackle for loss by the Illini defense. This defense is stingy, Jay. They are going to challenge you to run the football. They're going to challenge you on the outside with man coverage.
Timeout, Brett Bielema.
Illinois. First of the half.
Ahead of the second and 11. There's defensive coordinator Ryan Walters going to talk things over. Their defense pitching a shutout right now, up 7-0.
What?
Kevin Connors in studio, second screen viewing mandatory today. We've got Notre Dame and Navy over on ABC. Drew Pine, a pair of touchdown passes. LSU and Arkansas, the Bayou Bengals off the thrilling win over Alabama last week on ESPN. And how about SMU a week ago? 77 points in that game, taking on USFJ on ESPNU.
Yeah, he's not even in the screen right now.
Big hit! Drilled in the backfield again, wrapped up at the 10-yard line. Deion Burke swallowed up. Quan Martin on the tackle.
Quan Martin is fun to watch. He is becoming an NFL draft prospect week by week. We talked with the staff here. They said this guy, the people are starting to ask questions. Who's 21? Well, you keep making plays like that, you're going to get on the radar.
Third and long for O'Connell. Quick hitter. Wrapped up. Only got four, needed 14. TJ Sheffield stopped by Tariq Barnes, the quarterback of this defense.
Jay, this defense has been relentless. Watch the pursuit to the ball. You have almost all 11 orange hats running to the football. They are a nasty defense. On this day so far, three PBUs, an INT, two TFLs, and a turnover on downs. That's getting it done.
Tyler Strain, who had that interception, is down at the 21-yard line. As Illinois attends a strain. Let's recap the Purdue season because it's been a wild ride for the Boilermakers. Not been an easy ride for Purdue. Tough losses to Penn State and Syracuse in games they really could have won to start the season. Then the train gets back on the tracks. They win four straight, look really good, rolling right along. But the last 2 weeks, the wheels have fallen completely off, Dustin. They're not on so far in Champaign either.
No, so far, the last 3 weeks, it's been really tough, especially offensively. And those are two critical losses in the Big Ten West to both Wisconsin and Iowa. So even if Purdue wins this game today, Jay, they will need some help. They'll need the winner of Wisconsin-Iowa today to lose to Minnesota, and of course Purdue would have to win out.
Nice to see Tyler Strang get up, walking off the field. Purdue's punt unit is on. Jack Ansel with Isaiah Williams waiting for Illinois. Punting with the wind behind him. Bounces right over midfield. Williams lets it bounce, takes a big Purdue roll all the way near the 25-yard line. So quite a punt for Jack Ansel of 60 yards. And Tommy DeVito and the Illini offense back on the field when we come back up 7-0.
ESPN College Football, presented by Sonos, is brought to you by Crumbl Cookies, America's game day dessert. Taste this week's rotating flavors.
Illinois enjoying their best season since 2001, chasing another Big Ten title from the team that did it two decades ago. Dustin Fox, former Big Ten champion, national champion with the Ohio State Buckeyes. You said you played that 2001 Illini team.
We did. We played them in Columbus. Kirk Kittner and company. Really, really good squad. And it's been way too long since the Illini have been back in the Big Ten race.
A lot of suffering and losing in those last two decades. Really outside the 2007 season. It's a team that has been under 500 in Big Ten play until now. 7-2 season, and with offense like this, we take a look at our Oral-B drive recap, Dustin. They had it firing on all cylinders out of the gate.
They did. This drive was six plays, 74 yards, and a touchdown by Chase Brown. And since that drive, though, Jay, the last two drives, seven plays, 10 yards.
What's changed?
I think they need to take more shots down the field. That's what I think caught
there.
Purdue off guard on that opening drive. Since then, it's been more of the rushing attack and short intermediate throws.
DeVito was 2 for 2 on that opening drive. Mm-hmm. Since then, including that incompletion, he's missed 0 of his last 4. Back-to-back 3 and outs for Brett Bielema's offense.
Still waiting to see Isaiah Williams get involved here. He's in the stack, bottom of the screen.
DeVito looks that way, surveys the field, in trouble, down he goes. There's a flag in the backfield. It'll be declined because it's a hold. Prince James Boyd, monster sack on 3rd and 7.
Holding, offense number 63, penalty declined, fourth down.
That's a good pass rush. See the pressure come off the left side, and the hold right there is going to be on the right tackle, Palcheski. And I'll tell you what, this Purdue defense, after that opening drive, they have really shown up here in the remainder of this first half.
Charlie Jones awaits the punt. The wind knocks it right down. And it's down just past the 45-yard line, so great starting field position for Aiden O'Connell in this Purdue offense. Kick off your Sunday with NFL Countdown tomorrow, 10 a.m. Eastern on ESPN. They'll tell you everything you need to know. Our former colleague Jeff Saturday taking over the Colts. It wasn't too long ago he was talking with the Countdown crew, and now on the sidelines for Indy.
Great starting field position here for the Boilermakers.
First and 10 from the 45. O'Connell runs it. The Illini not expecting it. And that's a first down for Aiden O'Connell. He rarely runs the football. Coming into the day, he's got negative 68 rushing yards.
And when you say never, like, he never runs the football. Coach Brohm told us this week they want him each game 3 to 5 times to just take off and go. Now, this was a designed quarterback run. It was a speed option, in fact, and it caught the Illini defense by surprise.
Lauren, what do you got?
Yeah, going off what Dustin said, you know, running is not Aiden's strength. So usually you'll get a defense that drops Aiden coverage knowing he's not likely to run the ball. But as you said, Dustin, Coach Brohm has really been pushing him to try to run it 3 to 5 times, even on plays that he doesn't call. So opponents are going to play the pass against him, and he can find opportunities to pick up some of those ground yards that will alleviate some of the pressure that they've got on him.
Well, especially against this defense, they're going to play so much man coverage. If you can get the quarterback to run, you got an extra blocker in the box. There they go again. Same play, opposite side.
Flips it. Maccabee turns the corner. There goes Crazy Legs tiptoeing. Pushed out of bounds by Kendall Smith. Gain of 29.
Crazy Legs is right. That's the nickname that Coach Brohm called him this week when we had our conference call. And a good decision by O'Connell to pitch this football. And a good block on the outside. Payne Durham gets a block. And then you see the Crazy Legs down the sideline.
Told us it's like a baby giraffe out there, the unique running style for the redshirt freshman.
He has been a pleasant surprise for this Boilermaker offense.
Into the red zone for the first time today. Right back to Maccabee. Cuts inside the 10. He's down at the 6. Sydney Brown with a touchdown saving tackle. Gain of 11.
Boy, I thought that Maccabee was going to take this to the end zone. You're right, Sydney Brown, 30 here, cuts back and does save a touchdown here, but a really good run by Maccabee with terrific vision to cut this football back. It's going to be good. Just a walk-on. I surprised everybody in West Lafayette.
They go right back to Maccabee, and he's in! Touchdown, Purdue! A drive that belongs to Devin Maccabee. 4 carries, 46 yards for a Boilermaker touchdown.
Jay, this was the spark that the Purdue offense needed. You think about last week and then the start of this game, so many throws. To get something going on the ground, it's going to open up the passing attack for Purdue. Obviously, Jeff Brohm wants to throw the football. Sometimes can be a little bit reluctant to run the ball, but you get runs like that and your offensive line starts to get the push and Maccabee's breaking tackles. That's going to be huge for the rest of this ball game.
Tied at 7 in a Big Ten West rivalry game. This game could very well decide who's going to play for a Big Ten championship in Indianapolis. The Boilermakers punch back to tie it at 7. All tied at 7 in a Big Ten battle between Purdue and Illinois. Dustin Fox, former Buckeye national champion, Jay Alter with you. How about Devin Maccabee? Now 700 yards on the season. That's third most for a Purdue freshman in program history. Just a 2-star recruit who was headed to Navy about 2 weeks before practice started for Purdue, and now their leading rusher on the year. Scores a touchdown to tie it at 7. That was a drive, Dustin, that usually Purdue likes to air it out. It's all ground game right now.
Well, that was their best drive of the day, and you can see Maccabee outrushing the nation's leading rusher in Chase Brown so far early in this game. You know, Brown was really effective on that opening drive, and since then, that Purdue defense, they have shut down the Illini. That's surprising.
Brown had 30 of those 36 yards on the opening drive. Since then, he's been quiet.
You know, Maccabee, he's been battling injuries too. He didn't even practice barely at all the week before Iowa. Looks healthy today.
They go to Brown on first down. Powers forward for a gain of 4.
remember the wind in the face of Illinois on this final draw or final quarter before the half here. And these flags are just whipping around inside Memorial Stadium.
Right back to Brown, puts his head down, falls forward for a gain of two, sets up a third and four. The Illini 0 for 3 on third down today.
It's a bit of that like diagonal wind, Jay. It's kind of not a true crosswind. But you saw it in that last punt by Illinois. It just knocked that football down.
Very difficult to throw into it. That's why both teams are really keeping the football on the ground. DeVito throwing here. Isaiah Williams, the top target, picks up the first down on a gain of seven. His first reception of the afternoon.
And that's their first.
Down to line or Purdue player on the sideline of the Illini. Clyde Washington stays down. Midway through this second quarter, not much to separate these two Big Ten West rivals. And Jeff Brohm's team, despite losing the last two games, still very much in this divisional race with an opportunity to win the Big Ten West and play for a Big Ten championship, but it requires a win today. If they lose, that path is gone.
It'll be interesting if Purdue can find a way to stay in this thing. You know, they've got a schedule remaining. You know, Northwestern and Indiana, both winnable games for Purdue. They would certainly need some help.
Not a lot of help.
You would have a four-way tie in the West next week if Purdue wins this game.
Hey, you take a look at those West standings. Illinois alone at the top. They are in the driver's seat in control. Wisconsin playing Iowa today, so one of those teams is going to go to 4-3. So you're right, Dustin. If Purdue wins, they just become huge Minnesota fans because they have the tiebreaker against the Golden Gophers, and Minnesota plays Wisconsin and Iowa in the next 2 weeks.
I think we would call it the Wild Wild West the next couple of weeks to determine who will play Michigan or Ohio State.
It's funny, a lot of coaches that we talk to, they don't talk about standings. They just, we need to go 1-0. Brett Bielema says every Sunday, he brings the team in. He goes, what's going on in college football? Hosted by Brett Bielema. And he says, we got to win two of the next three. We get to play for a Big Ten championship.
He says he'd rather control the narrative.
Yeah. He embraces it. They go through the college football playoff rankings. Here's DeVito. Play action. Airs out a deep ball. It's caught. Casey Washington, beautifully thrown by DeVito, and that's the big play the Illini offense had been looking for.
And this is a great adjustment by Casey Washington, and Illinois is going to get up to the line of scrimmage here and maybe run a little bit of tempo as they got across midfield.
Into Purdue territory for the first time since the opening drive.
Into the end zone.
What a great play design, but it comes up with nothing to show for it.
The reverse double pass. Ryman is wide open down the field. OC Brothers, the linebacker in coverage, sort of slips a little bit. And as Ryman's kind of backing up for the football, I don't know if he takes his eyes off it or what, but that should have been caught.
Hits him right in the hands. DeVito throwing again. Dropped again. No, they said he caught it and fumbled. Purdue's got the football. No whistles blew the play dead. It was Hightower who coughed it up. Obviously, this will be reviewed.
Cam Allen ends up with the ball.
It's a catch. It was fumbled. Recovered on the
Yeah,
certainly you're right, Jay. They'll take a look at this play.
But the call on the field is a Hightower catch and drop, a fumble.
Wow.
Scooped up by Cam Allen. Purdue football as it stands. And this will go to review.
And the question is, does Hightower make a football move?
But he looked down.
Previous play of a catch and a fumble recovered by Purdue is under further review.
And forget if it was a football move. Hightower looks down.
It may be a catch. The ball was certainly moving as he's going to the ground. There's a lot to look at here for the replay officials.
James Robinson, the replay official today.
Yeah, I mean, to me, when you look at that, I mean, that could go one of two ways.
Three ways, really.
Well, it could be an incomplete pass, it could be a catch, or it could be a catch fumble.
Right. So those are the
we
three options.
Wait.
But the call on the field was a fumble.
Correct, correct.
A catch and a fumble was what the officials on the field called. And again, officials have done a fabulous job. What they don't want to do is blow it dead. They can always go back and review it and take back the fumble, but if they blow it dead, they can't then adjudicate the fumble. Wow, that's just such a tough call, because the ball is moving, but I think that knee is down, Dustin.
So I personally, looking at this replay, feel like it's a catch with the knee down. But my percentage on calling these correct is very average.
I wasn't going to bring that up.
So I'm just going to stand out of the way and allow the officials to make this call. Very difficult call to make.
And remember, this comes a play after Illinois should have had a touchdown. Trick play, DeVito hits the tight end, tip Ryman wide open. Would have walked in for an Illinois touchdown. Instead, offense stays on the field, and this could very well be a fumble. We'll take another look. So let's start with, was it a catch or no catch? You think it's a catch?
I think it's a catch.
And then,
so at that point, you're looking for the knee.
I think that knee's down.
This could be a huge sequence, Jay, for the outcome of the game. I mean, you hit on it. They just basically dropped the touchdown pass the play before with Tip Ryman.
Does the ball start to pop out before the knee is down? That's what James Robinson, the replay official, is looking at right now. Taking a long time on this review, and that just shows what a difficult call it is.
Yeah, it really is. There's so many different things to look at on this play. Does he have possession right there?
After further review, the wide receiver had control of the football with a knee down at the 23-yard line. Prior to the ball comes loose, the ruling of field has changed. First down, Illinois.
So it goes overturned. Instead of Purdue football after the fumble, Brett Bielema's offense stays on the field at the 23-yard line.
And this is huge because the Illini, after their opening drive, have really not been able to move the ball. This has been their best drive since that opening drive. So this is obviously huge for the Illini to try and get points here before halftime.
And it's a first down for Tommy DeVito. They go to Chase Brown, the nation's leading rusher. Hard hit at the 20. Purdue's rush defense has done a really nice job to bottle up Brown ever since that opening drive, Dustin.
Yeah, they really have. And you know, they come into the game at the bottom against the run in the Big Ten. West, I should say.
Eighth play of the drive. Isaiah Williams on an end around, trying to spin out of tackles. No gain.
That's a really good job by Purdue's defense setting the edge. Cam Allen comes up, number 10, and forces this back inside and allows the rest of the Purdue defenders to rally to the football.
Critical third and seven for an Illini offense that struggled on third down today, just 1 of 4. DeVito back to throw, surveys the field, now tucks and runs. He's got the first down inside the 10, bounced out of bounds. Tommy DeVito improvising, gain of 12 with his feet.
Great decision by DeVito to take off and run. This thing opens up. It's wide open for DeVito. And then how about down the field? DeVito's kind of awareness to play off of Chase Brown, number 2, who's getting a block down the field. And DeVito picks up that first down. That's huge.
Here's Chase Brown. Cuts. Stays on his feet. Touchdown, Illinois. And he strikes the Heisman pose. Chase Brown, second touchdown of the night.
And what a turn of events, too. When you think Purdue, their sideline was thinking they're going to have the football. After a turnover, it gets overturned, comes back. DeVito takes off for the big first down inside the 10-yard line. Then Chase Brown caps off the drive with his second touchdown run of the day.
Now, we were talking with Illinois' coaching staff, the players here. They feel like Chase Brown is getting disrespected nationally. They think he should be in the Heisman conversation. And what does he do? He scores his second touchdown of the game, and he hits him with a little Heisman, Dustin Fox.
Wants a little bit of respect at the end of this play. They miss a face mask there too, by the way, but here you go. He wants to be in New York City.
Kevin and Sam in studio. That Tennessee offense is humming again. Hendon Hooker to Princeton Fant.
He's got nearly 200 passing yards, but don't sleep on Missouri. Missouri scored. It's a one-score game. And all the, by the way, 4 of their 5 losses have come from one score or less.
A tight one, Jay.
Yeah, Dustin and I saw that Missouri team a week ago in a brutal loss to Kentucky. That defense is one of the best in the nation.
We've seen two of the best defenses in the entire country back-to-back weeks. Certainly they're tested against Hendon Hooker and that offense of the Volunteers. But all of a sudden, we've got a little offense here in Champaign.
Chase Brown with both touchdowns for Illinois. Deion Burks drilled at the 25. Chase Brown, we've told you he's the nation's leading rusher. He's been over 100 yards in every game this season. Nice job to stay on his feet, and then he hits everybody with the Heisman pose. They know about him on this campus. This week, a huge honor. He got put on the alma mater here on campus. Beautiful bronze statue that sits in the heart of Illinois' campus. Little makeover, donning that number 2 that Brown wears every Saturday. Illinois, their sports information department telling us it's the first time in 100 years of the alma mater statue existing that a football jersey has gone on there. They've done basketball before with success on the hardwood, but Chase Brown, the first to ever be put on the alma mater, and for good reason. I mean, they really think he should be in the Heisman conversation.
He should be in the Heisman conversation. And the problem sometimes with that award is it goes to the best player on the best team. That is so cool. What an honor for Chase Brown.
He's backed it up today. O'Connell in trouble. Hit as he released it. They blow it dead.
That was really close to being a fumble.
Johnny Newton shot out of a cannon to hit O'Connell. Brings up 3rd and 9.
Ruling on the field is an incomplete pass.
This defense is nasty. We'll see Johnny Newton, number 4, on the inside. For as big as he has got a motor to him. Just the get off to get up the field and then the swipe of the football. That's nearly a fumble. But now a big 3rd down and long where this defense is going to tee off.
6 on the line for the Illini. Pin their ears back, bring pressure, set up the screen to Maccabee, battling forward. Only got 5.
It doesn't matter the down or distance. This defense will challenge you, whether it be 3rd and long or 3rd and short. Listen, defenses that I played on throughout my career, if it was 3rd and long, we're playing zone coverage. To sit back there on 3rd and 11 and put all your cornerbacks at the line of scrimmage and have a middle field safety 25 yards deep and just say, beat me. And that's exactly what Illinois does, and it's effective.
Ryan Walters, defensive coordinator for Illinois, has such trust in his defense. Fair catch called for, but then backed off it. Let's check in the studio with Kevin.
And Jay, coming up on the Geico Halftime Report, I'm sure Dustin will be happy to have us check in on The Ohio State University in the horseshoe or snowshoe, as it were. Today, we'll talk about what makes the Buckeyes elite. We'll also check in on Tennessee, of course, off the loss a week ago. And Sam Acho on a potential dark horse candidate for the Heisman Trophy coming up when you join us at the half.
Oh, Kevin, it wouldn't be November in Columbus without a little bit of snow flurries, right?
Hey, there's something about Big Ten football in November.
I love it.
Cold weather like we've got today in Champaign. Two teams battling in a rivalry game for a trophy, trying to play their way in to a Big Ten championship game. Reggie Love in the backfield for Illinois. He gets the carry. Dustin Fox, Lauren Sisler, Jay Alter with you. A terrific game here between Illinois and Purdue. Winner of this game could very well go on to win the Big Ten West, play in Indianapolis for a Big Ten championship. Illini leading by 7. They're going to have a 3rd and long here after back-to-back unsuccessful runs. Lawrence Johnson, great job stuffing the gap.
Kind of conservative here by Illinois. These first 2 plays of this drive, just 2 minutes and change remaining.
Jeff Brom elects to take his first of 3 timeouts, conserve some clock.
Absolutely.
He's going to hope that he can get Aiden O'Connell and the offense back on the field after this 3rd and 11 stop.
It's freezing down there on the field. Lauren, how cold is it down there on the field?
I can barely move my lips. Every time I go to open my mouth to talk to you guys, it's very much a struggle for it to come out.
I can hear it.
Hey, but you know Coach Bielema said, look, they rarely practice indoors. He said maybe 6 times in the entire time he's been here. So Illinois prepares for this kind of weather. He says unless it's lightning, we're practicing outside in the elements. And so, you know, these guys are bundled up down here, but they don't have the big heaters out like Purdue does on the other sidelines. They got the heated benches, but not the big heaters.
Well, you are a warrior today, Lauren.
Why, thank you.
We appreciate it.
3rd and 11. They're going to let DeVito throw. Slings it to the far side of the field to no avail. Reggie Love jacked up. No gain.
Great tackle on the edge by Reese Taylor in the open field. And now another timeout by the Boilermakers. And remember, Jay, they're going to get the football back here probably with good field position. The wind in the face of Illinois.
Kicking into the wind.
And then they'll have the wind at their back. Remember, they missed a field goal attempt earlier in the first quarter with the wind in their face.
Good time to remind you, Monday Night Football, 8 Eastern on ESPN, ESPN Deportes, and the ESPN app. Now we've got a rivalry game today in the Big Ten, NFC East rivalry game. Washington in Philadelphia at the Link. Coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown at 6. Now, Brett Bielema spent 2 years in the NFL in between his stint at Arkansas and here at Illinois, and he told us that he was surprised how much NFL locker rooms lean into divisional rivalries. It's something that he's even take back with him to the Big Ten. Obviously spent a lot of time at Wisconsin, won 3 Big Ten titles, but he said he's really this week driven into the fact that you're playing for a trophy. This is a divisional rival. Forget the Big Ten championship. Forget you're going to go to 8-2. Let's win this trophy, a trophy you haven't won in 5 of the last 6 meetings.
Yeah, and I think it's also allowed Coach Bielema to keep his team focused on one game at a time. And sometimes that's difficult when you're in a Big Ten division race, right? You're thinking about next week against the Wolverines, finishing up against Northwestern. And that cannon allows them to just focus on today.
Yeah, he told us he didn't come to Illinois to win 5-6 games a season like they'd been doing. He came to win Big Ten titles, win rivalry games like this one. O'Connell throwing on first down, right on the money, hauled in by Charlie Jones, Purdue's top target, into enemy territory on the first throw of the drive.
Great throw by Aiden O'Connell on the corner route, and Charlie Jones does a terrific job just getting that 1 foot in bounds before he goes out of bounds.
Only a second catch of this first half. Leads the Big Ten in receptions. O'Connell throwing again. And it's defensive pass interference.
Picked off by
Witherspoon. Off by Witherspoon. There's a flag down, though. They tried to go right back to Jones. Witherspoon intercepted it.
Well, there was a lot of contact by both players on the outside.
Yeah, I guess it could be against Jones. Let's get the call. Against Witherspoon. Second DPI that he's been called for today.
Well, he is very physical on the outside, and he knows he's got a heck of a matchup here today. He's frustrated by the penalty, but this is something we've been watching all day. Man-to-man coverage every snap against Jones. He's in good phase. Well, I don't know about that call. I think that is one you let play on.
They threw the flag before Witherspoon made the interception.
Well, that is a tough call, and if Purdue's able to get some points here, you may look back on that as a big turning point in this ball game. Fans are letting the officials know.
The penalty negates the interception. Purdue stays on the field. O'Connell floats it. It's caught! Touchdown, Charlie Jones!
Wow. Quan Brown, from our vantage point, Jay, looks like he's going to go up and make an interception right around the goal line. And somehow the football appears to go through his hands and into Charlie Jones's hands in the end zone. Watch 21 at the end of this play. It looks like it's going to be a surefire interception. Game of inches. Just can't get up enough into the air to make that interception.
That's a risky throw from Aiden O'Connell, but it pays off. Right at the end of this first half, a monster touchdown to Charlie Jones. O'Connell threw it to Jones. 3 straight plays, 2 catches, a defensive pass interference, and just like that, Purdue has tied the game at 14.
Charlie Jones battling through so many injuries, just able to kind of get himself to game day week in and week out. Now, this is the one rare time that it's not Witherspoon matched up with Jones on the outside. It's Martin. Look at this ball. O'Connell's got all day to throw. I mean, you think about this. Even if Martin's able to get a fingertip on that pass, maybe it deflects it and Jones can't haul in the touchdown. Charlie Jones, the transfer from Iowa, had only 21 catches at Iowa a season ago. You know, and coming into this game, had 83 receptions. Three catches already. 14 catches away from 100 on the season.
And just like that, he's over 1,000 yards on the season. 10 touchdowns. Leads the Big Ten in yards and receptions. O'Connell put it just an inch out of the reach of Quan Martin. An Illini defense that leads the nation in interceptions thought they were going to have another one. Instead, a Purdue touchdown to tie it at 14.
You know, Witherspoon was so soft-spoken with us yesterday. We had such a fun chat with him. The coaches told us, you will see this guy in game day. It's like a different person. It's like Jekyll and Hyde. When he gets out there on the field, he is just like electric. Super hype at all times, talks a lot of junk. And as a former cornerback myself, I can respect that. And him and Jones, that's been the battle all day.
And what a journey it's been for Charlie Jones. He starts in the MAC playing for Buffalo and transfers to Iowa. Or you're just saying, Dustin, had some production, but not the level of production that he's seen at Purdue. Certainly a match made in heaven with the Boilermakers leading the Big Ten in receptions and receiving yards. Illinois offense back out onto the field.
You wonder how conservative they want to be here. They'll get the football. You know, back to Jones for a minute, Jay. It's crazy the story. Aiden O'Connell, the quarterback here at Purdue, childhood buddies with Charlie Jones.
Yeah.
He went to the coaching staff and said, you got to look at Charlie Jones.
Let's get this
guy. They basically said, okay, we'll take a look. Boy, this has panned out big time for the Boilermakers this season.
And because of that penalty, Illinois backed up all the way to their own 15-yard line. There's O'Connell and Jones, played youth baseball and football together, and there's just something about that chemistry.
They've had it since they were just kids.
And now you're seeing it.
The connection.
In the Big Ten, the big-time game that could decide who wins the West. Illinois, very conservative play call.
This Purdue defense, you know, the last couple weeks, much maligned. Didn't know what we'd get today, what to expect. Talking with Coach Ron English, the defensive coordinator, he was excited, Jay. When we talked to him this week, he was like, this is Big Ten football in November. We're playing for something. He was like, our guys will be ready to play.
Yeah, I mean, despite the losses to Iowa and Wisconsin, if Purdue wins today on the road, favorable schedule, Northwestern and Indiana, a chance that they could wind up in the Big Ten championship. Illini just run it with Brown. Tripped up at the 25.
He takes a lick there from the safety, Bryce Hampton, number zero.
That'll likely be the final play of this first half. Illinois does get the ball to start the third quarter.
All we do is call close games, partner.
It's a lot of fun.
This crew gets close games every single week, and we got another one here in Champaign. Purdue's fired up here going to halftime.
Tie ball game and a Big Ten rivalry game. This is going to be a fun second half between Purdue and Illinois. Let's get you to the studio. Kevin Connor, Sam Macho.
Yeah, Jay, a tight one, a cold one.
We welcome you back to ESPN College Football presented by Sonos. back in Champaign, Illinois. Both teams coming out of the locker room for this second half. We told you it's a Big Ten rivalry game. You saw them coming out of the respective locker rooms. There was a big brawl right at the 20-yard line.
Something was going on there, and both teams not happy. And certainly the way the first half ended, they almost got into it at the end of the first half, going back to the locker room. The officials had to separate that, and they had to separate this as well.
Yeah, geographical rivalry, only about 90 miles separate these two schools. But more importantly than that, yeah, they play for a trophy, but they're playing to try and get to a Big Ten West championship, a Big Ten championship game in Indianapolis. Yeah. Dustin Fox, Jay Alder with you. I mean, not much to separate these two teams. You see that obviously the juices are flowing coming out of halftime tied at 14. What stood out to you about the first half?
I think we talked a lot about this Illinois defense, how good they are. They only give up 232 yards per game. In the first half, Purdue, 229 yards of offense.
Yeah, no, they've done things to this Illinois defense that teams have failed to do all season long. For the Illini, both rushing touchdowns through the nation's leading runner, Chase Brown.
Yeah, Chase Brown was really good in this first half. They really only had two good drives. I give Purdue's defense a lot of credit. At times, they looked like they were Illinois' defense. A couple of big plays on the outside. That was at the end of the first half. Charlie Jones from Aiden O'Connell to get this thing all tied up 14 apiece.
You mentioned it, Dustin. Yes. That Illinois defense, number one in the country in so many categories, struggling today against Aiden O'Connell at Purdue.
For whatever reason, this offense here with Aiden O'Connell at the helm, they've done a really good job moving the chains today. They were very ineffective a week ago against Iowa. They were 2-for-13 on third downs. They have been just unbelievable today, especially offensively, as we're talking about. They've already got 15 first downs. And, Jay, this is a battle for the West.
Yeah, we showed you the scuffle coming out of the locker room to start this second half. That's why it's a rivalry game with huge implications for these teams. Tied at 14 as we start this second half. Both teams still bouncing up and down on their respective sidelines. Part of that might be trying to stay warm. It's a cold one. It's Champaign. Let's check in with Lauren Sisler on the sideline.
Hey, guys, talking to Coach Bielema going into the locker room, he said, we've done some good, we've done some bad, but we've got to do a better job of maintaining our drives. And then defensively, he said, we've just got to do better at the depth possession. The corner position has really hurt them. Right now, they're down to their fourth and fifth guys. He said, those guys have to take advantage of this moment right now. But right now, it's 0-0. We've got to be ready to play all the way through the fourth quarter.
Or did you get some hot cocoa at halftime?
I did not. I wish I did.
It's freezing down there.
Now, there was a flag on the kick to start this third quarter. Still waiting for the call, though. Officials taking a long time to talk this over.
At the end of that first half, Jay, from the pass interference call on Witherspoon that would have been an interception by Devin Witherspoon that turned into then the next play, the ensuing play, I should say, a touchdown to Charlie Jones. That was just a wild sequence. The fans were not happy with that. You can just tell the tension is brewing here in Champaign.
Officials are over speaking with Jeff Brom on the Purdue sideline. Just trying to figure out what was the call on this opening kickoff. Here's Jeff Cervinski.
During the kick, personal foul, illegal blindside, black, kicking team number 32. That penalty is declined. Purdue's football, first down and 10 at the 25-yard line.
So here comes Aiden O'Connell.
Well, I think they mean Illinois football.
They're right. Tommy DeVito. Yeah, they said Purdue football, yeah, which would mean Aiden O'Connell, but it's Illinois ball.
They just misspoke, yeah.
Yeah, Tommy DeVito coming out there. What would you like to see more of from DeVito in the second half?
Well, listen, on that opening drive, I thought they took shots down the field. And the one thing you look at on their two scoring drives, on first down, they're averaging 8.8 yards per play. The other five drives, just 2.4 yards per play. So if they can get a good start, it's going to allow for success.
Play action. DeVito rolling right, slings it to the tight end. Chopped up. Tip Ryman, only a gain of two. Jalen Graham in on the scene quickly to make the tackle.
It's been kind of a weird first half, Jay. Kind of clunky. Didn't have a lot of rhythm. You know, Purdue put up a ton of yards, but just 14 points.
DeVito throwing again. Knocked away. Flag flies in. Late flag.
Pat Bryant was just begging for this flag. There was a lot of contact down the right sideline. Corey Trice in coverage.
Defense number 23.
And they call
penalty includes an
Trice
first down.
For the penalty. First down, Illinois.
Yeah, we had Purdue earlier this season. Trice is the prototypical corner. 23 in man coverage. You'll see at the end of the route, a lot of contact here. A lot of jersey grabbing, and kind of hard to tell from that angle, but Pat Bryant gets up. He's begging for the flag. And again, as cold as it is, I think it sometimes takes a while for the officials to grab the flag and actually get it out. So it's
not necessarily a
late flag. Yeah, absolutely.
First and 10. Illini ball at the 42-yard line. Play action. DeVito steps up, throws. Incomplete.
He's trying to get Bryant again over the middle. Jay, he had all day to throw, and this thing just opens up wide open, but it's thrown a little bit behind Bryant as he's going to the ground, but he still has to come up with this catch. That's just got to be caught.
Illinois suffered three drops today. Brown out of the backfield. Gain of four. Sets up a third and 6. Purdue's defense has been very strong on third down today. Brett Bielema's offense just 2 of 6.
This is kind of a situation, too, if you're going to throw the football and you're Tommy DeVito, potentially take off and run. The way Purdue has played defensively, there's been opportunities to do that.
DeVito threads the needle for the first down. Pat Bryant comes up with a big catch after he dropped one earlier on this drive. Gain of 10 to move the sticks.
And then he totally redeems himself. Comes right back to him on a big third down. He has the drop and the first down throw, this one in traffic.
Chase Brown hit at the line, ball popped out. DeVito falls on it.
Brown is down.
Now he pops up.
Okay, that's good news. Looks like he's still kind of gimpy.
Reggie Love runs in. Brown takes a knee.
And Coach Bielema is arguing that he was down.
I don't think he is.
No, that ball's out.
Fortunate to have DeVito in perfect position
to
jump
question.
On.
And you just wonder what happens to Chase Brown here. Sanusi. Kane coming in there. 21. Big hit.
Chase Brown still getting medical attention. Now runs off the field under his own power.
I think the folks here at Memorial Stadium breathe a sigh of relief.
He's got both touchdowns for Illinois today. 14 carries, 65 yards. Had 9 consecutive 100-yard plus games to start this season. I don't think he's going to be out of this game for long.
No, he's as tough as they come.
Reggie Love into the game. on the left hip of DeVito. He's got three wide receivers bunched up to his left side as well. No targets over to the far side of the field. Now Williams in motion that way. DeVito tried to get it to Isaiah Williams, dropped it again.
Just some easy catches that should be made here by Illinois. Not typical drops by Isaiah Williams. He's been really their top target this season at wide receiver. Just trying to get the football in his hands in space. That's where he's most dangerous. And the long catch and run a week ago against Michigan State for the touchdown. And now third and a mile.
Need to get all the way to the 34-yard line to keep this drive alive. DeVito in trouble. Going to try and pick it up with his leg. Stopped short. Needed 14, only got 9.
That puts him in position to potentially go for this now. To pick up that, those 9 yards, Coach Bielema and offensive coordinator Barry Lunney to keep the offense on the field. They talked about this, though. They decide on first down whether or not they're at an area of the field where they're going to go for it on fourth down, fourth and 5. And here comes Williams in motion. Oh, no. You're going to get a false start on Palcheski.
Illinois jumped.
False start. Offense, number 63. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
And just like that, punting.
An Illinois offense that had lost to Michigan State last week was brutal on fourth down. 1 of 6. And on this attempt, they don't even get the play off because of a penalty. Punt unit comes on. Hugh Robertson kicking into the wind here. And Purdue has 2 punt returners out there, Charlie Jones and Reese Taylor. You rarely see an error from Alex Palcheski. He's been a staple on this Illini O-line.
He's been starting for Illinois since you were in diapers.
A Big Ten record, 62 career starts. Incredible. Robertson. Line drive. Bounces to the 10 and then rolls out of bounds. Purdue's defense stands tall, dusted, and now an opportunity for Alec Aiden O'Connell and his Purdue offense to really take control of this game for the first time.
And really, Jay, I think the direction you're going on the field matters. And for Purdue, you've only got the wind at your back here for the third quarter. This is going to be a huge drive for Purdue to take advantage of that.
Throwing on first down, finds Mockaby, breaks a tackle. Positive yardage after the catch, gain of 7 for Devin Mockaby. He's been really strong out of the backfield today for Purdue.
Yeah, he's been dynamic. The redshirt freshman walk-on has taken over the running back job, and I thought this was very close to being an offensive pass interference call on Payne Durham, but there's a no call.
102 total yards for Mockaby. They go right back to him, churning those legs forward. Doesn't give up on the run. First down. Keith Randolph had the stop, but Mockaby ran right through him. Let's check in with Lauren.
5 yards, first and 10 for Purdue.
Coach Brom coming. Hey, guys, I talked to Coach Brom coming out of the locker room. He said the guys are playing hard. He likes the fight. You saw that emotion coming out of the locker room. We just can't turn the ball over, and we have to sustain these drives. We're moving the football. We just got to score in the red zone, convert on fourth down. It's about getting more positive plays and winning those one-on-one battles.
O'Connell to the tight end, Payne Durham. Dustin, offense has not been the problem for Purdue. They had as effective a first half as anybody in the country has had against Illinois.
I don't think that anything's been the problem for Purdue. They played a pretty solid first half offensively and defensively. They got down to the 26-yard line twice and came away with 0 points. So they've moved the football. Their defense has played great. They just got to put it all together here in the second half.
O'Connell cuts up, keeps it himself. Longest run of the season for Aiden O'Connell. Takes it for 24 and falls right down at the 50.
And just like Lauren said earlier, Coach Brahms looking for, 3 to 5 runs from O'Connell. He's not the shiftiest guy in the world. You can see it. He gets there through the defense. He just sits down. He's not trying to take a hit. But that's now 2 big runs for him today.
Usually O'Connell is all arm. Some even describe him as a statue back there, but he's shown that he can take off. The Illini clearly do not have him accounted for in the run game. As he finds
no, they're not
Sheffield.
Worried about him at all, and I think Ron may have found something there. I'm not saying they're going to run him a ton, but just once in a while, like you said, 3 to 5 times a game, if he can take off and scramble, especially against this defense that plays so much man coverage, their backs are the quarterback. No one even saw him till he got about 25 yards down the field.
And we told you it was a season-long run of 24 yards. The previous was 9, so he more than doubled it up. There's a flag on the field during the 2nd and 4 rush.
There's no foul in the legal formation.
Second down.
So they pick up the flag. That sets up a 3rd and 1.
Now clearly, I think this is 4-down territory for Purdue. Do you take a shot on 3rd and 1 knowing you're going to come back and maybe?
I don't think so.
No? Okay.
Get it to Maccabee, move the chains.
Yeah, they're going to go heavy formation here.
I don't think they're taking a shot.
They're going to bring Tristan Cox in at fullback, the linebacker.
Maccabee dives for the first down and gets it. Gain of 3 to keep the drive alive. Hard-nosed, cold weather, Big Ten football in November. Everybody's freezing, trying to grind out a win that could very well decide who wins the West.
And this game feels like it could come down to whoever has the ball last. In a game where both defenses have played extremely well.
Maybe now you take your shot. 1st and 10. O'Connell throws incomplete.
What coverage by Quan Martin Jay on the outside. They're trying to get the football to Sheffield, number 8. And right as the football is delivered to Sheffield, you'll see 21 Quan Martin come get his hands in there, almost like just fight through the ball with his helmet to get that thing out. That's a great defensive play.
4th pass breakup of the game for this Illini secondary. One of the best units in all of college football. They've allowed the least points in the country, the least yards in the country, and the most interceptions. Now trying to get off the field. Timeout taken by Purdue. Play clock was winding down. Jeff Brom burns his 1st of 3 timeouts. We've got a fun one, tied at 14 between Illinois and Purdue.
Veterans Week coverage on ESPN, brought to you by USAA.
At ESPN, everybody here salutes Americans' heroes for their incredible sacrifice and service to our country. You're looking at some of the brave men and women from around the world supporting their Purdue Boilermakers in the black and gold. Those are the pilots that orchestrated the flyover before kickoff here in Champaign. Dustin Fox, Jay Alter, Lauren Sisler. A battle in the Big Ten. A tight one. Not much to separate these two. O'Connell has Sheffield wide open. There's a flag down to the 30-yard line. But as it stands, a huge gain to T.J. Sheffield, 34 yards.
And what a play on the outside. There's some conversation. This might be coming back.
During the pass, holding defense number 8.
Staying corrected.
Hills declined. Result of the play is a first down.
It was Quan Martin on the coverage against Sheffield on the outside. It was a double move. And what a ball by Aiden O'Connell.
You rarely see this Illini secondary get beat like that.
Yeah.
Wide open.
You'll see it out and up. And Martin starts to peek into the backfield, and that's when you get beat on double moves. What, and what a throw. Right on the money. As Kendall Smith saves the touchdown. And you'll see at the top of the screen, just going to run that out. And just the subtle peek into the backfield is going to allow Sheffield to get wide open down the field.
Ball at the 4-yard line. First and goal. 10th play of the drive. O'Connell goes under center. Here's Maccabee. Stuffed at the line. Gang tackled and driven back. Tariq Barnes, the first to get there. And now some commotion over on the Purdue sideline.
And this thing is very, very chippy between both these teams. And the officials trying to do their best to keep it in check. It's the third time, Jay, we've seen a bit of a scuffle between both these teams. And no flags yet.
Including coming out of the tunnel to start this second half.
You'll see Barnes on the edge, number 8. Does a great job standing up Maccabee and driving him back and allowing the rest of the Illini defenders to get there. This is just team tackling, pursuit to the football.
Forward progress, only a loss of 1. 11th play of the drive. Purdue trying to punch it in. O'Connell rolling right. Surveys the field. Great coverage. Just had to get rid of it.
This is just great coverage by the Illini. They're playing man. But it's almost like they're playing basketball out there as they kind of pass off the routes. And they do such a great job with communication in the back. And you'll see as all the routes are coming across the formation, Kendall Smith drops back. They do a great job. And a really good decision, frankly, by O'Connell to just throw that ball away.
Brett Bielema calls his defense the best fire department in the country.
Can they put out the flames here?
O'Connell. Rolling left. Floats back in the end zone. Jump ball. It was caught. Touchdown, Purdue. In front.
Jay, this was so close to being out of bounds.
And a flag comes in.
And they may just want to take one more look at this, Jay. It's hard to tell if Durham got a foot in, because one foot was definitely near the white.
Field is a touchdown. After the play was over, on sportsmanlike conduct, offense number 8. The previous play is under further review.
So a couple things that are big here, right? They're going to take a look. Is it a touchdown? If it's not a touchdown, it'll be fourth down, and they back them up. So it makes the field goal attempt
really a question of which foot comes down first, because the right foot is in the end zone.
The left foot
is out. So what foot hits first? Jump ball back of the end zone. Really.
Charlie
tough
Jones
to
comes
tell.
Into the screen there, yeah, so you can't see it. The foot, which blocks the official's vantage point.
I don't know that you can overturn it from those looks. Again, very,
unless
very
they're
close.
Seeing something we're not.
Yeah, but. I mean, very close. It's almost like simultaneous because that left foot comes down like the toes.
I think that right foot might be down
first. I think he's in, Jay. I don't think you can overturn this.
What a great ball by Aiden O'Connell to just float it up there only where Payne Durham could go and get
it. Well, you said it early in the game. I felt like the tight ends and the running backs, especially in the pass game, were going to become effective in this game. Looking back the last couple of weeks, Nebraska had 7 receptions for 132 yards against Illinois, and Michigan State the same.
After further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Touchdown. The unsportsmanlike conduct on number 8, which is his first of the ball game, will be enforced on the ensuing kickoff.
Penalty for unsportsmanlike conduct will be enforced on the kickoff. How about Aiden O'Connell on that drive? 5 of 7, 56 yards and a touchdown. Also that run that really sparked the drive for a career-long 24 yards.
But for a team that has just dropped 2 games in the row in conference play, and you wonder at 5-4, which Purdue team's going to show up? They have played inspired football today, Jay.
Playing with intensity, the rivalry juices have been flowing.
And the key, I think, is not playing from behind. For the last couple games, early in games, turnovers. The longest drive of the season, 90 yards, 12 plays. Payne Durham caps it off. Do we have an upset brewing in Champaign? We'll find out. Sing it. I can't even lie. What a time to be
alive. Drinks in the sky. That's the vibe. ESPN College Football, presented by Sonos, is brought to you by USAA. This Veterans Day, join us in celebrating all those who serve.
Memorial Stadium stands as a very special and sacred monument to the University of Illinois students and alumni who gave their lives during World War I and World War II. The names of the fallen soldiers inscribed on each of the 200 columns that support the east and west sides of the stadium and remain a living testament to the ultimate sacrifice that they gave to this country.
No doubt, and also want to give a shout out to the veterans on our crew. David Theobald working the camera down on the field, Victor in the audio department, of course, and Tom Murdoch, our EIC. Thank you for your service.
Thank you to your service, everybody who's a veteran, wherever you are watching around the world. There's David.
My man.
Staying warm down there.
This isn't California where he's from.
Midway through this third quarter, Purdue. Longest touchdown drive of the season, 12-play, 90-yard drive, and just like that, the Boilermakers have their first lead of the afternoon. Backed up because of the unsportsmanlike penalty. This will be a returnable ball for Pat Bryant. Plenty of green grass in front of him. Cuts at the 30 and gets all the way past the 35. Let's check in the studio with Kevin. What's going on?
Well, Jay, Missouri has battled Tennessee all day long, but Acho, it's tough to stop Jalen Hyatt.
This is a 6 50-plus-yard touchdown catch, but notice he was hidden. He was lined up as a tight end. That confused the defense and got him wide open down the sideline.
7 catches, buck 46, and that touchdown 35-24. Meantime, Cade Fortin, third stringer, fighting Matt Landers.
This is the only offense that Arkansas has been able to have, but they're getting it exactly when they need it.
Just a 3-point game, guys, over on ESPN.
Illinois trailing for the first time today. Jay Alter, Dustin Fox, Lawrence Sisler with you. Now the blue and orange respond. They go to the nation's leading rusher, Chase Brown. Good to see him back in the game after he limped off earlier in the first half. Lawrence Johnson, the tackle for Purdue. That rush defense has been stout all afternoon long, Dustin.
Yeah, they really have, Jay. Coming into this game, that Purdue defense giving up 120 yards a game. Today, they've just played inspired football. It feels like right now Purdue has all the momentum.
Tommy DeVito on Illinois trying to grab it back. Play action. DeVito in trouble. Has to throw it away.
Boy, he had his target coming over the middle. 89, Tip Ryman, the tight end.
Bryce Hampton on a safety blitz. Put all the pressure on DeVito.
And really, if Hampton doesn't get home on this play, DeVito's going to have a wide open Tip Ryman.
Third and eight for the Illini. They've struggled on third down today, just 3 of 8. DeVito steps up, evades pressure, launches downfield. It's intercepted, but there's a flag. Jamari Brown.
He pushes off to create the separation. This is going to go on Jamari Brown, number 7. Trying to find Casey Washington down the field.
The contact prior to the interception will negate the interception.
Pass interference.
Pushes him
defense
in the back.
Number 7. 15-yard penalty.
And that's an easy call to make for the officials when you see both hands on the back there.
We have had multiple calls now, Jay, on both teams that have been pass interference calls that would have been interceptions overturned. And that's a tough one because that ball is underthrown a little bit. It's really kind of all Jamari Brown can do to come back to the ball. Goes through the wide receiver.
So instead of the interception, Illinois' offense stays on the field in Purdue territory. DeVito, clean pocket, delivers. Brian Hightower, great grab of first down and a lot more gain of 22.
This isn't bad coverage by Corey Trice, 23. But excellent ball placement. Look where this football is thrown. Thrown only to a place that Hightower can get, to his back shoulder, and then a missed tackle by Trice.
Chase Brown. Makes a few men miss, finally stopped at the 18-yard line. Illinois back into the red zone.
How many guys does Chase Brown make miss in this Purdue defense?
Number 9, start counting them right now. Off. He's out for one play.
About 5? Goodness, what a run. Never stops his legs. And that's the thing about Chase Brown. Not a lot of big, explosive runs, Jay. But he's always going to get that 5 or 6 yard carry.
The Illini back in the red zone. They're 2 for 2 today. An area that's plagued them all season. Only 40% of their red zone trips this year have resulted in touchdowns.
111th in FBS in red zone efficiency.
They've been effective today, trying to keep it going. DeVito finds Pat Bryant, tangled up. Just shy of the 10-yard line, gain of 5.
And that's what Barry Lunney was talking about with us, Jay. Yesterday, we chatted about the red zone issues. He says a lot of times, yeah, there's plays I want to call back, but we got to execute when we get down here.
And the scoring, 75%, is a little misleading because a lot of those are settling for field goals. Only 40% of the red zone trips have resulted in touchdowns. That is what they're going to try and come up with here. They've done well to punch it in today. Brett Bielema said, all about execution. Second and 10 upcoming. 7th play of the drive for Tommy DeVito in this Illinois offense. Isaiah Washington cuts at the 10, stays on his feet, ankle tackled, falls forward to the 3-yard line.
This is all Isaiah Williams. You know, he comes around. He's got blockers in front. But Sanusi Kane, number 21, is going to be able to make this tackle, but he misses the tackle. Williams is so shifty in the open field. He cuts up. There's a missed tackle. He picks up an extra 5 or 6 yards.
They mark him about a half yard shy of the first
is
down
there
marker.
Any question who's getting the football here?
This is Chase Brown territory. Everybody on the line except for Brown. No, DeVito keeps it. Trying to push the pile with a quarterback sneak. He got more than enough for the first down, so it'll be first and goal.
That's what I meant to say.
From the 2 yard line.
Quarterback sneak. Great call by Barry Lunny there on third and about a yard. Just what a push by the offensive line to go into a heavy package. And in fact, it looks like you get the right guard, Zy Chrysler, actually behind doing the old Matt Leinart push, right?
Nine on the line for the Illini. Chase Brown running behind him. He stopped short, did not break the plane. Second and goal upcoming.
You know, they did this a lot last season, Jay. They would bring in seven offensive linemen. They call it the barge formation. And they would just get that big push, and DeVito just kind of churn his legs. Maybe they go back to it here.
DeVito under center. Three options behind him. He keeps it himself. Stuffed. Great penetration from the Purdue defensive line. And that brings up third and goal.
Well, the interesting thing about this, obviously it's going to be third and goal, but they're eating a ton of clock right now. And when the fourth quarter comes around, that's going to favor Illinois big time because that wind will then be at their back. And obviously still some work to do to here to get into the end zone. That clock is ticking.
And 5 minutes alone, taken off on this drive. 11th play of the drive, trying to punch it in.
Oh,
tons
no.
of movement.
You got a false start on the left side. It's going to be Palcheski, who's typically the right tackle, but because of this formation, lines up on the left. Unless it was on the defense. A little bit of a conversation.
Offense number 63. 5 yard penalty. Third down.
Second false start of the afternoon, and this one's a costly one.
And it looked like he was almost drawn off sides by the defensive shift. And I think that's what the frustration was on Illinois. Branson Dean, their defensive tackle, moves, just kind of shifts over. You'll watch. 58, that's Dean. But he almost makes a move with his hands like he's going to do a pass rush. And I think that that's what kind of creates the movement by Palcheski.
They fail to punch it in on first and second and goal from the 1 yard line. Now third and goal from the 6. DeVito throws to the end zone. It's caught! Touchdown, Illini! Brian Hightower, and DeVito put it right on the money.
What a throw to the back of the end zone by Tommy DeVito. You know, we asked Tommy DeVito yesterday, do you have any favorite targets on the outside? He's like, no, I love them all. But in certain situations, there are certain guys that you go to a little bit more frequently. And down here in the red zone, the 6'3", 215-pound wide receiver out of Los Angeles, California.
Bunch of flags
and, more flags
and another scuffle.
And more scuffles. Goodness. And another flag.
Rivalry tempers starting to flare. the end of this third quarter.
Jay, this is Big Ten football, man. November, we got a tight ball game, a battle for the Big Ten West. It's getting spicy.
Illinois ties the game. What an answer. 11 play, 63-yard drive that chewed up 5 minutes and 36 seconds.
The try is good. After the play was over, there was two unsportsmanlike penalties against Purdue. Number 90 is his first. Number 6, that's his first. Those 15-yard penalties both will be enforced on the ensuing kickoff. Timeout on the field.
Wow, and Illinois is going to kick off from about the 50-yard line. They've got a tight one in Champaign. You see? A little 7-on-7 crime. Brian Hightower working against Jamari Brown. Great throw by DeVito. We're tied in Champaign.
I'm a fighter, cutthroat, I'm a winner. Stone cold my...
You're watching the Big Ten on ESPN. Dustin Fox, Jay Alter with you. All tied up at 21 after the Illinois touchdown. And Dustin... the Illini kicking off from the 35-yard line after two unsportsmanlike penalties.
I would try an onside kick. What do you have to lose?
Oh, true. Good point. They do. Bobbled, but then brought in by Purdue. Great heads-up call by you, Dustin.
Yeah, very rare that you would see multiple unsportsmanlike penalty calls that are assessed on the kickoff. But what do you have to lose in that situation? You're kicking off from the 35. Purdue was ready for it, but this is a good kick. I mean, he bobbles the football, and that could have been a game changer.
This is the second time this season that Purdue has had an opponent kick off from their 35-yard line because of unsportsmanlike penalties.
On PATs.
Yeah. Tied at 21 in a Big Ten West battle. O'Connell throws, finds Charlie Jones. There's a flag at the line of scrimmage.
And O'Connell's kind of gimpy here. I'm not sure, there may have been contact on him after the play.
Personal foul. Hands to the face. Defense, number 93. The 15-yard penalty is added to the end of the run. Includes an automatic first down.
Calvin Avery called for hands to the face. We've seen it all game long, Dustin. A rivalry game, battle for the Cannon Trophy, battle in the Big Ten West, but you can't let the aggression, the temper, lead to penalties.
Yeah, the emotions, really. I mean, this is, you'll see 93 in the middle of your screen. That's Avery. Gets up in the center. Hartwig's face mask. And that's going to get called every single time.
Under a minute left of this third quarter. Knotted at 21. O'Connell throws. Incomplete. Way over the head of Abdur Rahman Yassin. We have not seen him in a couple of weeks for Purdue. Brings up second and 10.
You're Purdue. You got 42 seconds left with the wind at your back. Maybe take a couple more shots down the field.
Risky against an Illini secondary that leads the nation in interceptions.
And you've got Durham coming in here in motion.
Play action. O'Connell rolling. In trouble. Escapes. And just throws it. And there was contact after O'Connell went out of bounds. He was clearly just throwing that ball away. And what were we just talking about, Dustin?
Discipline.
Emotions in a rivalry game leading to penalties. Now this is going to go against Johnny Newton.
Personal foul, roughing the passer. Defense number 4.
And if you're Illinois, that can't happen.
15-yard penalty. Was an automatic first down.
Jay, you've already given Purdue 15 yards free on this drive. Now add another 15. That's the right call.
Can't put your hands on the quarterback out of bounds.
He's in the white, and you put your hands on the quarterback, that's going to get called.
Fifth Illinois penalty on defense that has led to a Purdue first down today. Those are backbreakers.
Just wild to think that, you know, Illinois just kicked off from the 35-yard line. They try an onside kick. They nearly recover it. And now Purdue inside Illinois territory because of penalties.
30 yards of penalties. Can Purdue cash in at the end of this third quarter? Maccabee. Hard running for a gain of five. Juan Martin to tackle for Illinois.
Remember at halftime, Jay, there was a bit of a scuffle. And really what happened, it's down here around the 15, 20-yard line. It looked like Purdue was trying to warm up into Illinois' warm-up. Which I don't know what's going on with that, but I could see the frustration from Illinois.
Well, that's what has lit the fuse here in the Cannon Trophy game. But there's energy. There's rivalry flowing through the bloodstreams of both teams as this third quarter comes to an end. Fourth quarter in a Big Ten rivalry game, all tied up at 21. We've got a fun finish coming in Champaign. We welcome you back to ESPN College Football presented by Sonos. Start of the fourth quarter on Senior Day in Champaign. A Big Ten rivalry game all tied at 21, Dustin Fox.
Yeah, we've got a fun fourth quarter ahead, partner.
And a critical third and four to start this fourth quarter. O'Connell, clean pocket. Steps up, incomplete.
Oh, another flag.
A flag comes in at the 30. Rice, the intended target.
They're going to get Scott, the freshman. Boy, there was a lot of tangling up.
Esther Fierks, defense number 14. The ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Includes an automatic first down.
And that is the sixth time today that an Illinois defensive penalty has given Purdue a first down.
And you'll see the crossers. Yeah, he's got the jersey of Sheffield. I think that's the right call. But again, Jay, good point. You said the sixth time?
Sixth time.
Oh, goodness.
What an opportunity this is for Purdue. On the road, trying to keep their Big Ten West hopes alive. A penalty extends the drive. They're in Illini territory. No gain there on first down. You know, a reminder to everyone what this means in the Big Ten West title race. Illinois started the day in front, in control, but they need to win to stay in front. Purdue and four others hot on Illinois' tail.
And listen, this Illinois defense, they've only given up 7 points in the fourth all season. Their season average, and they step that fight like Brett Bielema calls them.
Connell taking a shot to the end zone. Incomplete, but another penalty flag thrown in the end zone against Sidney Brown in coverage on Deion Burks. Brown can't believe it.
Wow, this is a close call. I thought Sidney Brown.
Esther Ferris, defense number 30. 15-yard penalty. It's an automatic.
You know, he does
first
look
down.
Look at his head turned back around, but does he have him hooked? I don't know about that call. They've been calling this game very, very tight. Both sides have had multiple pass interference penalties.
Well, you just said it. 10 penalties against Illinois. They've been backbreakers today. This one puts Purdue in the red zone. Brett Bielema calling this defense the best fire department in the country because they always come to the rescue. They've only allowed one touchdown in the fourth quarter through 9 games this season. Can they get off the field here? Maccabee tumbling through traffic. Only a gain of 3. As a defensive back, Dustin, how do you not let yourself get frustrated with all these defensive pass interference calls and just focus on the next play.
I think you just got to still play your game. Trust me, I would know. I think I led the Big Ten in pass interference penalties my senior year. It can be frustrating, but you can't let it get off your game.
O'Connell in trouble. Throws, nobody home. Miscommunication with Maccabee out of the backfield brings up third and seven.
Well, the question here is, can Illinois force a field goal attempt and not get a pass interference call on them? Because they're going to substitute to match up with Purdue. Huge third down. Could be the ball game, potentially.
Play action. O'Connell. It's caught. Payne Durham dragging a man all the way for a Purdue touchdown. Late touchdown signal given. Payne Durham muscling his way to breaking the plane and firing Purdue back in front.
All game we've been talking about the tight end being an issue for the Illinois defense the last 2 weeks. In this game, Payne Durham, who's going to play in the NFL, has had a monster game working there against Kendall Smith, the safety. Just kind of drags him into the end zone and turns his backside over the goal line.
This is the most points Illinois has allowed all season. Durham, two touchdowns today. He was put on the Mackey Award, which goes to the best tight end in the country, semi-finalist list this week. He's backed it up, two touchdowns, and he's got Purdue in front, 28-21. Payne Durham, the fifth-year senior tight end. He's got two touchdowns today. The last one has put Purdue up 28-21 in a huge Big Ten West rivalry game. Look at those numbers. Six catches, 64 yards, two scores, and Purdue playing a terrific ball game on the road. Well-deserved lead.
Yeah, very impressive. Again, didn't know which Purdue team we would see, the team that won four straight earlier this season, or the team that just struggled against Wisconsin in Iowa the last couple of weeks. Boy, Aiden O'Connell has been terrific, and this was a challenge. My goodness. You know, this is one of the best defenses in the entire country. And you know, their defensive coordinator, you see him right there, Ryan Walters, does not have any answers right now for Purdue.
Illinois will start just shy of the 35-yard line as we check in with Kevin Connors in the studio.
Jay, Tennessee has four rushing touchdowns in the game. Acho Hendon-Hooker, three through the air.
And nearly 600 yards of total offense. This Tennessee offense is looking like they did all season long outside of that Georgia game.
49-24. Meantime, Vanderbilt taking the lead on Kentucky. Mike Wright, the touchdown.
Vanderbilt is in the midst of a 26-game SEC losing streak. It may be broken in a few seconds.
They're in front right now, 24-21, Jay.
We've got a fun finish shaping up in Champaign. Jay Alter, Dustin Fox, Lauren Sisler with you. Purdue's just jumped in front at the start of this fourth quarter. Tommy DeVito throwing on first down. It's caught. Pat Bryant hangs on to that grab.
And this is Tommy DeVito time. And this is why he transferred from Syracuse to Illinois for his final season. This is an opportunity for the young man to play for a potential conference championship and play in rivalry games like this.
Timeout for an injured player.
Pat Bryant's down, Lauren.
Yeah, guys, talking about Tommy DeVito's career and kind of how he made this transition. Late in December, he made the commitment, and that was before offensive coordinator change had been made, but Coach Bielema, even DeVito himself, knew that a change was coming. So he did some research, learned as much as he could, leaned in to Barry Lunney, and felt confidence in his decision to bring his talents to this offense at Illinois. DeVito trusted the process, and in return, it really helped him establish that confidence and establish a tremendous amount of trust with his OC and quarterbacks coach, and feels this offense allows him to be himself, and more than anything, has allowed him to play free.
The offensive coordinator Barry Lunney joked with us, look, it was an arranged marriage,
yeah,
but the parents, in this case Brett Bielema, did a really good job arranging it because it's worked out through nine games of the season. I guess now the marriage gets put to a test on this drive, trailing by a touchdown. You need to win this game if you want to keep your Big Ten West aspirations alive and play in Indianapolis for a Big Ten championship.
And I really think it's on the offensive line here, Jay, as well, because they struggled a week ago in that loss to Michigan State, and Barry Lunney challenged them this week. They've got to find a way to protect Tommy DeVito, give him time, try and tie this ball game up here and get a victory that would put them in the driver's seat for the Big Ten West.
It looks like Pat Bryant is headed to the locker room, not walking back to the Illinois sideline, instead towards the tunnel. So that's a primary weapon being taken away for Tommy DeVito on this drive. Let's take a look at this week's college football playoff rankings, brought to you by Vrbo. Georgia at Mississippi State tonight on ESPN. Ohio State taking care of business against Indiana. And then all eyes on undefeated TCU at Texas tonight on ABC.
It was funny talking with Tommy DeVito yesterday. I had the important questions for him. Like, what's it like coming from the East Coast here to Illinois, Midwest, right?
New Jersey native.
It's all about the pizza, right? It's a little bit different style of pizza here.
He said that was the biggest adjustment. Not the new offensive coordinator, not the new offense.
That good chicken parm.
Yeah, the Italian food lacking a little bit, in his opinion, from what he gets back home.
He is a connoisseur. Said his mom is one of the best cooks around.
He's trying to cook up a touchdown drive here. Chase Brown breaks two tackles, finally shoved out of bounds. Gain of two.
Chase Brown, the ball.
Brown's been over 100 yards in every game this season, leads the nation in rushing, but today he's got the two touchdowns, which is good, but only 72 yards. Purdue doing a really nice job containing him.
And they have. This is probably the best I've seen this Purdue defense, at least in terms of running to the football and really playing team defense. We had him earlier this year. Oh, boy.
Trouble. DeVito scurries back, picks it up, throws.
Wow, that was such a great decision by DeVito. How does he get this football off? And I think there was a receiver in the area. It looked like Isaiah Williams was the target, because if he is outside the tackle, if he's not inside the tackle box.
Well, the officials are obviously discussing this. I think Isaiah Williams was in the area.
I do too.
Brett Bielema shouting from the Illinois sidelines, pointing at Isaiah Williams. Take another look. DeVito just not looking as his ball snapped.
But great awareness. I think he does get outside the tackle box.
Disconcerting signals. Defense.
Wow, that's what made the snap. We've had that multiple times this year. It's been an emphasis by the officials. Any sort of motion audibly that would make the offense jump, or in this case, the errant snap, they're going to call that.
So we think they're talking about whether it was intentional grounding or not, and instead they're discussing something different entirely, and it goes against Purdue.
Well, we've seen it all in this game.
Signals. Yeah.
And you know what, Jay? That happened earlier in this game, down around the goal line, and they didn't call it. I wonder if the officials then have now been looking at that from a defensive perspective. Purdue has done that now twice.
Timeout,
they
Purdue.
Shift, and they do that little hand movement, Jay, that makes the offensive line think they're rushing the passer at that point.
Timeout on the field.
Jeff Brohm can't believe it. He takes a timeout. We'll step aside as well. 12 minutes to play. Purdue leading Illinois by 7.
ESPN College Football is presented by Sonos. Experience game-changing sound made easy. And in part by Lincoln Financial. Plan, protect, retire.
Well, Veterans Week all week here at ESPN, brought to you by USAA. A salute and a thank you to all veterans around the world as we welcome you back to Champaign. Jeff Brohm took his second timeout, so they've only got one remaining, and spent the entire timeout just chewing out the officials, clearly not happy with the call. Should have been a 3rd and 8, instead 2nd and 3, which goes for a loss of 1.
This is just a great job by Jalen Graham, the hybrid linebacker, coming down the line of scrimmage and making the tackle for loss. And Jalen Graham missed 4 games earlier this season with a foot injury, and they're happy to have him back on this defense.
Well, Brohm was upset that it wasn't 3rd and 8. Now he's got a 3rd down for his defense here. DeVito steps up, deflected, incomplete. It was Jalen Graham again who got a piece of it. Back-to-back huge plays for the senior middle linebacker.
Jalen Graham sort of struggled to get back, you know, his game shape. You see number 6 right here, gets a paw on the football. Again, you mentioned back-to-back plays by Jalen Graham, probably one of the most athletic defenders on this Purdue defense.
So for Jeff Brohm and Purdue, ball don't lie.
Well, I think you would consider going for this here in certain situations, but with the wind at your back, why not pin Purdue deep and see if your defense can get the football back to you with good field position?
Charlie Jones lets it bounce over his head into the end zone for a touchback.
Oh, no. Sidney Brown and Jamari Brown both throw their helmets off. Look, they're about to throw blows.
We've seen these rivalry tempers flare all afternoon long.
Sidney Brown and Jamari Brown on the coverage were just going after each other, and they both get up and slam their helmets to the ground like they were about to have a boxing match.
6 personal fouls in that 3rd quarter alone. Clearly, the rivalry juice is still flowing in this 4th quarter. You know, no matter what the records are, this is always a huge game for both teams. Cannon Trophy on the line, but with this being pretty much an elimination game for the Big Ten
One
West,
each team.
You can see what it means to these guys.
Purdue.
Sidney Brown
number
with
7.
A push.
That's his first. Unsportsmanlike conduct.
After the play.
Illinois, number 30.
Helmets down.
That's his first.
And then Jamari takes his off and says, what do you want? You want some?
First down and 10.
It's about to be a back alley brawl. Not about you, Jay, but my juices are flowing, man. This game has had all kinds of scuffles, near fights. I mean, they are just going at it.
Now, the fuse has certainly been lit in the Cannon Trophy game, and now Illinois' defense with a tall task. They got to keep this a 1-score game. Purdue with the football. Aiden O'Connell under center. Devin Maccabee behind him. Gets the carry. Thrown down behind the line. Keith Randolph blows it up in the backfield, loss of 1. Great individual effort from Randolph.
There's no doubt, and we have not called Randolph's name all afternoon. That's a huge stop, tackle for loss. His 11th TFL on the season.
Seven on the line for the Illini. They bring 5. O'Connell throws it incomplete. through the hands of TJ Sheffield, and that'll bring up third and long.
And just a drop by Sheffield on the outside. Quan Martin was in coverage, and now the stadium comes to life on third and 11. What does Ryan Walters dial up, the defensive coordinator for Illinois? They have not really got pressure on O'Connell all day.
O'Connell looks in the direction of Jones, checks down to Sheffield, who lost his footing, and Purdue will have to punt after a three and out.
So a huge stop by Illinois, and the decision to punt the ball on fourth and short pays off.
Because now Purdue has to punt into the wind. Awaiting this punt at the 50 yard should be excellent point. Snails scared to great punt into the wing backtrack. Calls for a fair catch at the 33 yard line. Let's check in with the studio, Kevin.
Yeah, and Jay, we want to let you know John Rhys Plumlee and the 22nd ranked UCF are set to take on number 7 Tulane, top two teams in the American. Both eyeing a New Year's Six bowl invitation. This game will start on ESPN News, and you'll see it here on ESPN2 after we go final. Jay.
Yep, we'll get it there as soon as we wrap up in Champaign. A terrific Big Ten contest in November. Cold weather, both teams battling in a rivalry game, knowing the loser of this game is probably out of contention in the Big Ten West. Here's DeVito, taking a shot on first down, into coverage, incomplete. Isaiah Williams and Brian Hightower, the two targets for DeVito, but just excellent coverage by the Purdue secondary.
I think he was trying to get to Williams. You know, he throws this football in a very dangerous spot. Actually, I think the target there was going to be Hightower, and Williams just thinks maybe the ball's overthrown and just trying to make a play on it. Lucky to have that one back.
Chase Brown in the Illini run game has anchored this team all season. They go to Brown here. A huge hole's opened up. He runs right through it into Purdue territory. They lean on the nation's leading rusher, and he delivers. There's a flag down at the spot of the tackle. As it stands, it goes for 25 yards through Chase Brown.
You're going to get a hold on Illinois. It'll still be a first
holding
down.
Offense, number 85. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Second down.
Penalties have crushed the Illini this afternoon. That's their 11th of the game.
Great run by Chase Brown, and it was his longest of the day. And the holds down the field, working against Reese Taylor, the cornerback. Miles Scott, of course, number 85.
So a gain of 25, now just a gain of 8. Second and 2.
I thought the spot was going to give him a first down, but still, the second and about 2.
Right back to Brown.
Wow, what a hit.
Absorbs a big hit, but it's enough to move the sticks, gain of 3.
Kadren Jenkins, number 44, delivers the blow to Chase Brown, but nonetheless a first down. And maybe they're getting a little something going here with Chase Brown this fourth quarter.
DeVito throws, incomplete. Big hit over on the near sideline, Corey Trice. No flag comes out, he was all over Miles Scott.
I think that was a clean hit by Trice. The football a little bit overthrown on the outside. Fans here erupt. Anytime you see contact like that down the sideline, I think that's clean.
DeVito escapes pressure. Down he goes! Purdue dials up the biggest sack of the afternoon. Corday Cinder delivers. Loss of 15.
You know, for a minute, it seems like DeVito is going to get out of this and escape. But Sidnor's there. And there's nothing DeVito can do. And now you're just in an impossible situation here. Third and forever. Third and 27.
Yeah, third in Chicago.
Yeah, we'll be there later.
DeVito needing 27, checks it down. There's a flag in the backfield as well. Going to be well short.
The question is here, if this is a hold on Illinois, will Purdue decline it and try to back them up even more? Or will they just say, hey, we'll give you that short gain and make you punt the football? And they're asking Coach Braum that very question.
How about this Purdue defense?
Whew.
Holding offense number 63. 10-yard penalty, third down.
All right, so they're going to say, we'll take the yards, replay third down.
So third and 37 coming up now. This Purdue defense, it seems like maybe they took it personal this week. You know, all the talk about Illinois' defense and, you know, Purdue coming into this game, maybe not with a shot to still be in the Big Ten West race. But they have looked every bit as impressive as Illinois looked all season.
Yeah, with their season on the line.
A lot of credit to Ron English and Mark Hagan and company.
Third and 37. Purdue only sends three. DeVito checks it down to Chase Brown, who's immediately wrapped up. Wise decision by Jeff Brohm to enforce the penalty. 23-yard difference in where Illinois is now punting from because of that holding call.
Really, it was the sack that put him back. And then the holding call. Now it's fourth and 32. Charlie Jones back deep, a very dangerous return man. Had a 100-yard kickoff return last year against Illinois, playing for the Hawkeyes.
Robertson lets his fly from his own 10. Jones moves over and calls for the fair catch of the 30. That's where Aiden O'Connell of the Purdue offense will take over in a battle for the Cannon Trophy. Purdue leading by a touchdown. Madison Square Garden, UFC 281, and you're going to get two title fights. Main card begins at 10 Eastern on pay-per-view, with the prelims at 8 Eastern over on ESPN News. To order the main card, go to ESPNplus.com/PPV. Now we've got a title fight on our hands between Purdue and Illinois. Big Ten battle. Loser of this game eliminated from the Big Ten West contention. Purdue trying to cling on to this touchdown lead. Let's check in with Kevin Connors in the studio.
Yeah, and again, Jay, those who are tuning in to see the UCF Tulane matchup, top 25 battle and a colossal showdown in the American, you can see it starting right now over on ESPN News. Major implications for a New Year's Six Bowl on the line. You'll see it here on ESPN2 after we finish.
Yeah, Kevin, this is a time of year, middle of November, where in every conference at the top end of the standings, they are battling for bowl implications, who's going to play in championship games. Purdue on the road, really trying to keep all those aspirations alive. O'Connell finds McAfee, big hit. Witherspoon laid the lumber, and that'll bring up third and long.
Boy, Witherspoon just shows tremendous footwork, instincts, and awareness on this play. Just watch Witherspoon. He kind of bails into a cover two, right? Gets the jam on Jones, backs out, and then waits. And as soon as he sees the throw check down, he makes the play. Boy, this kid is going to play on Sundays.
Right now, just trying to get off the field. Can the Illini give their offense another chance? O'Connell finds the tight end, Durham. He's wrapped up, churning the legs forward. Going to be just shy of that first down. He was carrying Witherspoon on his back.
Well, Witherspoon gives up about 75 pounds here to Payne Durham.
At least.
I mean, this kid, we met him yesterday. He's not the biggest dude in the world. What an effort there to get Durham on the ground. Decision time for Purdue. I don't think it's much of a decision. I think you have to punt this football. You've got a 7-point lead. And your defense has played tremendous here all afternoon.
Devin Witherspoon, we were just talking about him.
Just look at the effort by Witherspoon. He's just trying to get his foot in the ground and get any sort of leverage. It's like one of those tug-of-war battles, you know, you see on the beach. That's just great effort. Back-to-back plays by Devin Witherspoon.
Timeout.
Timeout Purdue. Taken by their Purdue. That's final. Their final timeout.
Timeout of the half.
Boilermakers are out of timeouts the rest of the way with 4:35 remaining in this fourth quarter. Going back to Witherspoon, what a great story. He's absolutely going to be picked in the NFL draft in the first or second round. Totally under-recruited coming out of high school. He was actually committed to a JUCO, Hutchinson Community College. Gets the call from Illinois, turns into an absolute superstar. And we just saw it on back-to-back plays. He's given this Illinois team a chance to win this game.
It's just Witherspoon Island. I mean, you don't throw on this guy. The last six games, he's been targeted 20 times, only given up 5 catches for 19 yards.
Let's check in with Lauren.
Yeah, and I love Witherspoon's story. He's one of the stars on this defense, but his journey here wasn't always about football. He had the hoop dream going on until his mom convinced him to play football. He was late to the game, but of course he ended up committing here, and things have worked out pretty well for him.
Isaiah Williams lets this bounce. Takes a Purdue roll all the way to the 25-yard line. Here comes Tommy DeVito. The Illini offense with an opportunity with 4:24 to try and tie this game and keep their Big Ten championship aspirations alive. Take a look at the Taco Bell Live Live My Student section. Student sections across the country. Oh, and we've got some shirtless action in the Taco Bell student section. That's Livin' Moss for sure. Student sections all across the country competing for the Livin' Moss student section of the year. That, I mean, in 20-degree weather going shirtless, that'll put you in contention. DeVito throwing on first down. Incomplete. Hightower thought he made the catch. The officials run in and say no. Great coverage by Corey Trice.
Yeah, his knee hits out of bounds. It was a catch, but really good defense by Corey Trice. The 6'3" cornerback just gets him out of bounds here. And that knee hit just before the foot.
That ball bobbling, too.
The ruling on the field is an incomplete pass. That play is under further review.
Officials are going to take a look at this. I thought that ball was moving.
That was hard to say. I did think the knee hit first.
We'll step aside as the officials take a look. Illinois trying to tie this game up late in the fourth quarter. Fourth quarter, a fun finish coming in this Big Ten rivalry game. While we were away, the officials reviewed the incomplete pass. And it did appear Brian Hightower hit out of bounds as he tried to bring this ball in. So the call was confirmed.
And we did get confirmation from the replay booth that they did confirm it was a catch but out of bounds. So that knee, they're saying, hit before the foot. And so second and 10. Here we go.
Illinois does have all three timeouts. Plenty of clock to work with. Pitch to Chase Brown. Turns up field. Nation's leading rusher picks up 5. Brown has moved to second in Illinois school history in rushing yards with 99 yards today. Tonight on ABC, Saturday Night Football, undefeated TCU in Austin to take on Texas, trying to stay in the college football playoff top four. Coverage begins 7:30 Eastern time on ABC. Critical third and five. DeVito throws quickly, batted ball, it's intercepted! Kieran Douglas did a great job. The ball was deflected at the line of scrimmage.
Lawrence Johnson, the nose guard, 6'3", 310, gets his big paw on this football.
Timeout. Douglas brought it in. Purdue's defense fired up.
Watch 90 right in the middle of your screen. Just great timing.
And perfect position.
Perfect position.
Falls
yeah.
right into Douglas's carriage.
And they're trying to run the quick slant. And DeVito knew he had a matchup that he liked with Williams on Jalen Graham, the linebacker. That's where he was trying to go. But man, the Purdue defense, they came to play today.
Well, they've heard all the talk the last few weeks after losses to Wisconsin and Iowa, saying that, you know, Purdue, they were sitting at 5-2. Are they throwing away this season? Well, if they win this game, they've got Northwestern and Indiana left. A very good chance that they could still play their way into the Big Ten championship game.
They still got 3:37 to finish this game off. And Jay, Illinois, they've still got three timeouts remaining.
Douglas, the hero who came up with that interception, being carried off the field, dragging that right leg behind.
So because of the field position, Jay, the ball's going to be about, what, the 34-yard line?
Yep.
I don't even think Purdue would consider a field goal attempt here if it got to fourth down.
Into the wind?
Into the wind. They already missed a kick in the same direction earlier from about the same distance. So to me, if you're Illinois, you got to try and create some negative yardage plays here or need a turnover, because I think Purdue would go for it on fourth down.
If you're Purdue, you got to keep this ball on the ground, the clock running. With Devin Maccabee.
Now look how far wide they put the wide receivers. I bet they run to that side.
Maccabee goes right up the middle. He's met and driven backwards. Only a gain of one.
As Sidney Brown just comes up there and blows that ball.
Illinois.
Brett Bielema uses his first of three timeouts. Do you like that decision to take these timeouts immediately?
Without question. You want to conserve as much clock as possible. Even though I think they wouldn't attempt a field goal, you never know what Brett Brohm would consider. Finner and the kicker did miss earlier from 43.
Tuesday, you're going to get an exclusive reveal of the college football playoff top 25 rankings at 9 Eastern time, wedged in between two sonic blockbuster games at the State Farm Champions Classic, Kentucky and Michigan State. And then the nightcap, Duke and Kansas. I love this time of year. College basketball, college football, overlapping big time games. If you're looking for UCF in Tulane, that game is over on ESPN News. We'll get you to New Orleans when we finish here in Champaign. Second and 9. Play action. O'Connell set to throw. Heaves way over the head of TJ Sheffield. Incomplete. Gutsy call to throw it.
Well, Sheffield had the freshman Xavier Scott beat. If this football is thrown, and again, you're throwing into the wind on a deep ball.
But now you stop the clock because of the incompletion. Illinois can save a timeout. And third and 9 upcoming.
At this point, you threw it on second down. Maybe you come back here and throw it again on third and nine, try to pick up the first down and not let Illinois have the football back.
They run it with Maccabee, met at the line of scrimmage. Illinois uses that second timeout. Considering
Illinois,
you get intercepted at your own 34-yard line, this defense does as good a job as any defense in the country is putting out fires. They do it again here. Defense does their job. Fourth and nine upcoming. And I think there's a decision to be made here for Purdue.
All right, Jay, we talk about this every week on our crew. Who are we going to put in the foxhole? Somebody you want that's tough, that's physical, that makes plays? Well, today, that man is Payne Durham. Eight targets on the day, caught seven of them, all tough yards. Seven receptions for 70 yards and two touchdown receptions on the afternoon. This was great concentration, getting that foot down in the end zone. He's made plays in the run game as well, carrying defenders into the end zone. This guy is going to play on Sundays. Welcome to the Foxhole, Payne Durham.
Jeff Brohm leaves his offense on the field. Payne Durham certainly going to be the target, most likely on this fourth and nine. He's delivered all afternoon long. What do you think of this call?
I said it before they started the drive. You think you have to go for this. And you know it's going to be a pass. Fourth down and nine.
Need to get it to the 23. O'Connell surveys the field, steps up, throws. It's caught. T.J. Sheffield, biggest catch of the afternoon, 15-yard completion to keep the drive alive on a fourth and nine. Wow.
Well, that is huge conversion. And really, give the offensive line of Purdue a lot of credit. They keep O'Connell upright. He surveys the field. He feels the pocket move and then delivers the strike to Sheffield. Sheffield, who has had a couple of drops today, secures that catch and might have secured the win. Now, game not over just quite yet. Remember, because they threw on that third down incomplete, there is one timeout left for Illinois.
Maccabee bouncing outside the numbers. Down inbounds. Brett Bielema with that final timeout. But he decides not to use it. Take another look at this fourth down conversion.
Just had all day to throw. And again, kind of has that pocket presence to move. I don't know if O'Connell's going to be a high draft pick. But this guy's a gunslinger. I mean, he has been a great quarterback in the Big Ten.
Sixth year senior. 2 minutes away from a road rivalry victory to keep his Purdue Boilermakers in contention for a Big Ten championship. Maccabee. Only a gain of one and a timeout taken by Brett Bielema with
Illinois.
1 minute and 54 seconds
final.
Remaining. That is the Illini's final timeout.
Well, now you're obviously in field goal range. So the hope would be, if you're Illinois, can you get a stop here on this third down? And just a complete collapse, frankly, by Illinois' defense this afternoon on the season, only giving up 10 points a game. They give up 28. You know, in the first half alone, Purdue had almost 230 yards. And that's their total they give up on the season.
Why do you think Purdue had such success against this number one defense?
I think it might be frankly, might be the best quarterback they faced this season, and it's challenged their corners on the outside. And we just talked about Payne Durham. Payne Durham, one of the better tight ends in the entire conference, had a field day.
Two touchdowns for the tight end. The last one has been the difference. Third and four.
And Durham's in the backfield here.
A first down would end the game. Maccabee cups upfield, going to be close to that first down marker. I think he's half a yard shy.
Well, here's the question. Do you decide to just get up and maybe quarterback sneak this thing?
Well, you have an opportunity to make it a two-possession game.
I know
with a made
field
goal.
That's the tough question. But if you don't, Illinois gets another chance.
Field goal unit is on. Mitchell Finneran, veteran kicker for Purdue, fifth-year senior from 25 yards out. Puts it right through. Two-possession game. The minute and 5 seconds left. And for Illinois, it's starting to feel like a missed opportunity for a team that was 7-1. On the morning of November 5th, they lose at home to Michigan State a week ago. Now in jeopardy of losing to their rivals, Purdue, in the Cannon Trophy game.
This would... Well, here's what's going to happen now. If Purdue holds on, and it appears they will with the two-score lead in a minute to go, next week you'll have a four-way tie for first place in the Big Ten West.
The wild, wild west in the Big Ten this year. In Illinois, they lose that tiebreaker to Purdue. They've got to go on the road to the Big House next week. So this feels like almost an elimination for Illinois, whereas Purdue could move right to the driver's seat with a favorable schedule, Northwestern and Indiana remaining.
And just to clarify that, it's assuming Minnesota would win today against Northwestern, there'd be a four-way tie, otherwise a three-way tie. Nonetheless, you said at the Wild Wild West, it's completely up for grabs, and over the final 2 weeks of the season, who the heck knows who's been playing for the Big Ten championship game out of the West.
What a gutsy effort by Aiden O'Connell of this Purdue offense to go on the road after they struggled so mightily against Iowa a week ago, only scored 3 points the entire game. That was at home. Now you come on the road and lay 31 on the nation's best defense. Just an incredible effort. Illinois needs a miracle. Trailing by 10 with only a minute left, Peyton Vining does well to get to the 40. 59 seconds for Tommy DeVito and this Illini team to somehow, some way, find a way. Next two games on the road for Brett Bielema's team. So this, for a senior group that's been through so much, really orchestrated this turnaround under Brett Bielema, this would be a hard final game at Memorial Stadium. They've got a chance. They need to go 60 yards quickly.
And really, this salvages the season for Purdue.
Absolutely. DeVito checks down to Chase Brown. Into Purdue territory. Illini have to go quickly.
Just spike it. Here we go. We'll waste some time here.
DeVito tried to check it down again. Misses Brown that time. 42 seconds remaining. I know you don't want to throw a pick and end the game, but you got to start heaving it, right?
Well, here's what I would do. I'd be just trying to get 15 yards, spike it, and kick the field goal.
Because at least that gives you a shot.
At least gives you a shot to get the onside kick and maybe have a couple opportunities at the end zone.
You do have the wind behind you. DeVito throws over the middle. It's caught. Brian Hightower.
I'd consider spiking it right now and kicking the field goal.
34 seconds remaining for DeVito.
One more shot.
Clock runs under 30. DeVito steps up. Checks it down again to Chase Brown, who gets out of bounds right at the 20-yard line. Brown stays down after the tackle.
Oh, and that would be just devastating to see Time Chase Brown
for an injured player.
Injured in a moment like this. Lauren, what'd you see?
Yeah, he's laying on the ground right now, writhing in pain, pulled his helmet off, is in a lot of pain, and his brother is standing by as well in tears.
Oh, goodness gracious.
Watching him. As soon as he hit the turf, I knew he got tangled up. It looked pretty bad from just the initial impact to the ground.
Oh, my goodness. You hate to see this.
Yeah, and just seeing Sydney.
His twin brother
His twin brother looking at him, yeah. Standing by, watching in tears as well.
Those two have been through so much together. Powerful story as they've come down from Canada to play college football together and really orchestrate this turnaround at Illinois.
Oh, goodness. Hey,
Good to see him get up.
Feel so bad for that young man who's had such an amazing career, an amazing season.
Leads the nation in rushing this season.
Yeah, he's not putting any weight on that right leg.
And while all our attention has been on Chase Brown, and rightly so, Brett Bielema has sent Caleb Griffin in the field goal unit out.
I think it's going to be his right ankle.
Oh. So a 38-yard field goal attempt to stay in the game for Caleb Griffin. We need to make this, get the onside kick, and somehow heave a touchdown. Griffin drills it from 38. Pushing and shoving after the kick, like there's been all afternoon long between these two rivals. 17 seconds left. Got to get the onside kick and give Tommy DeVito a shot to get it to the end zone.
Well, at least it gives you an opportunity. You never know what can happen. You know, a lot of times teams don't decide to make it that one-score game, which baffles me. So it's the right call by Bielema. Now they need some magic.
Chase Brown heads into the tent. Illinois tried an onside kick earlier in this game when they kicked off from the 35-yard line after the two unsportsmanlike conduct penalties. So they've got an attempt under their belt. Can Caleb Griffin make the proper adjustments and successfully recover this thing? If Purdue recovers successfully, they will escape Champaign with a huge road win.
They've only got 10 guys on the kickoff team. Now they're going to run an extra man on.
Yeah, Casey Washington runs on. Well, this is the ball game. Griffin, that's not going to get 10 yards. And Purdue heads into a top 25 Illinois team and leaves Champaign with a road rivalry victory.
And the Cannon Trophy remains with the Boilermakers. What an impressive road win this is going to be for Coach Brohm and his staff for what's been a difficult year. Obviously, you start off with the tough loss to Penn State, the tough loss to Syracuse, which we called, and of course you win four in a row, and then you kind of feel like things fell off the wagon a little bit. The wheels fell off the wagon, and to come in here, what a gutsy performance defensively. And Aiden O'Connell, you can't say enough about what this kid did today.
Purdue bowl eligible with the win, right back in the Big Ten West title race. What a victory for Jeff Brohm and this Boilermakers team.
Can't say enough. You said it. They're bowl eligible and still in the race for the Big Ten West. Who would
have thought? That is the end of the ball game.
After the 24-3 loss a week ago to Iowa, need some help? But it's certainly possible.
And they've retained the Cannon Trophy. Trophy. They've won six out of the left last seven meetings in this rivalry game, including three in a row. There's the Cannon Trophy. It's going back 90 miles to Purdue. The Boilermakers do well to escape with a gutsy road win. That's all we've got from Champaign. For Lauren Sisler, Dustin Fox, our terrific ESPN crew, I'm Jay Alter saying thank you so much for joining us. Let's get you to New Orleans. Top 25 battle with Anish Roth. Yeah.